Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is consideration of whether to take item 3 in private. Item 3 is a consideration of evidence we will hear today on the railways. Do we agree to take this item in private? We are agreed. Our next item of business is an evidence session on Scotland Railways. In March last year, the committee held evidence sessions with the rail industry stakeholders and the Scottish Government in advance of ScotRail's transfer into public ownership. We agreed to keep a watching brief on the issue. The purpose of today's session is to take stock of ScotRail's first year in public ownership, considering the issues like industrial relations, fares and usage, and the future of the rail industry in Scotland. I'm pleased to welcome on our first panel Mick Hogg, the regional organiser and lead officer of ScotRail Caledonian Sleeper, National Union of Rail, Maritime and Transport Workers; Gary Kelly, the organiser for Scotland and Ireland Transport Salaried Staff Association; Kevin Lindsay, the district organiser and the Associated Society of Locomotive Engineers and Firemen; and Robert Sampson, the Senior Stakeholder Management for Transport Focus. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here, and we've allowed about an hour for this session, and we're going to move straight into questions, and the first questions are going to come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. Can I direct my first question to Robert Sampson from Transport Focus? Perhaps you could let us know what your passengers have been experiencing over the last year, what they're telling you in terms of the information you have. Studies identify that value for money as passengers' number one priority, but states that only 65% of ScotRail passengers consider the trip value for money. So what's your view on that? How can that be improved? And do you look at any lessons from other rail services elsewhere in the UK and across Europe? So there's quite a lot in there, but it's an opening to give you where are we now and what do you think can be improved, particularly for value for money?
Thank you. Value for money in all of our surveys is a top driver of passenger satisfaction, followed by punctuality and reliability. The fares freeze that's continuing with ScotRail has been welcomed by passengers. We look forward to the off-peak trial later this year as well to actually ascertain what value that has for passengers if it grows passenger numbers in ScotRail services. There's been a number of promotions by ScotRail that have been welcomed by passengers. The Kid for a Quid ticket as well. The off-peak market has grown. It's almost back to pre-COVID levels, which is good. What passengers actually want is an easy-to-understand fare system. Sometimes it's quite complex in actually navigating through the myriad of ticket offers that are available. Simple, easy to understand and easy to use. There's been a great take-up of mobile apps, etc., for passengers using that in travel, but we've produced a report recently about digital exclusion, so it's also worthwhile remembering that market as well. Make it easy to use. Passengers do value a visible staff presence at stations where they can get advice from ticket office staff on the best ticket for their needs as well. So there's a whole myriad, but the complexity of the fare system overall needs to be simplified so that passengers can actually buy the product they want. You know, when any other industry, to a large extent, it's your front door buying a ticket, and to make it easy and affordable, value for money. And linked to value for money is the punctuality, reliability. But there's millions of fares available, tickets available, so it's actually about simplifying and making it easier to understand for passengers. Thank you.
It's from elsewhere in the UK or across Europe that you are
Fares promotions help, but it's actually all of our work comes down to the simple factor of making it easy to understand and affordable and easy to purchase. It comes back to that across all operators across Great Britain. It comes back to the easy to understand fare system.
And have you picked up anything over the last year, particularly since ScotRail came under Scottish Government's direct control?
There's been no actual great change in the fare system in the last 12 months, apart from the uptake in the digital provision has been good on the mobile app. The flexible, we did campaign for flexible season tickets now that the commuter market has changed, and the introduction of flexible season tickets seems to go on well, offering a discount to passengers as well. So it's all about attracting people back to rail, and these initiatives seem to have helped in that regard.
Okay, and if I can now move to Mick Hogg, to be followed by Gary Kelly. First of all, can you maybe express what your experience is, both for your staff and indeed passengers, over the last year? Is there anything you'd like to tell us about what's happened from over the last year from your experience?
Well, certainly the value for money, first and foremost, and certainly reliability of the trains is absolutely crucial. What we actually need also is safe trains. That's very, very important for not just staff but passengers also. But what we need also is a train system that's free from antisocial behaviour. And we need to make sure that the train's use is affordable for staff. And we need to ensure that staff are actually in actual stations. That's very important, because if you look at the most vulnerable people within the society, they're very, very reluctant to actually use Scotland's trains if the antisocial behaviour issue is out of control. So we need booking offices to remain open. We need stations to be staffed in order to ensure that Scotland's railway is open for all. That's very important as far as the RMT is concerned. And we need to actually ensure that the antisocial behaviour issue gets addressed, because in RMT's view, it's getting worse, it's not getting any better.
Well, that's what I was wanting to ask you about, what's happened in the last year. You've obviously set out what you think is needed for the future, but is there anything you want to say before I move on to Gary about what your experience has been in the last year?
Well, we've actually seen an upturn in assaults, antisocial behaviour. Young people are actually using the trains and the stations as dens in order to actually continue with the antisocial behaviour. What we actually need is more actual legislation in order to address the antisocial behaviour, because the British Transport Police are telling us that they don't have the powers. And that's not to actually demonise young people. What we actually need is a robust system. And I've said this for quite a long time, and I'm going to say it again. If we can actually ban those people who are responsible for antisocial behaviour from the football grounds and the shopping centres, then why can't we actually ban them from Scotland's railway? You know, it's just bizarre as far as I'm concerned.
Thanks, Mick. And none of your staff should have to be subject to antisocial behaviour, and we've all got responsibilities to support you in that. Gary, over the last year, what changes have you seen? Good, bad, indifferent?
So, over the last year, I think it's not unusual that there haven't been any significant changes within ScotRail Trains Limited. Usually, after the first year after a 2P transfer, most employers don't really make any significant or substantial changes to the workforce. So, there haven't really been any massive changes in terms of the organisational structures. There's been no restructure. I think there's been a few changes at director level, a few changes departments across directorates, but in terms of the organisational structure within ScotRail Trains Limited, that's more or less stayed the same. I think maybe going back a wee bit further than a year, we launched a vision for Scotland's railway in October 2021, and there was one of the reasons why we did that is because there was a reduction in services of around 300 per day, so that's been a significant decrease in passenger services. I think they have slowly been increasing that back up again, but there are essentially less trains available now than there were previously. As Mick has noted, on the ground there's issues with antisocial behaviour. I think one of the other things as well is that there has been, over the past year, there's been an increase in the uncertainty of staff, particularly within the booking offices. There was a report commissioned by Professor Ian Doherty, which was commissioned by Abellio, and that recommended closing the booking offices. There was a Schedule 17 review which looked at the open and closing times of the booking offices through the network, and they recommended the closure of three stations. So we've successfully fought back against that so far, but the issue, as far as we're aware, has not been entirely taken off the table. So that creates a great deal of uncertainty in the booking offices through the network. We've pressed both the previous minister and the current minister to take those proposals off the table and essentially bin them, but we haven't quite received comfort and assurance that would happen. Other than that, I think the major changes in terms of the staff would be the potential impact or knock-on effect of the new structures coming in above ScotRail Trains, the holding company, etc. The imposition of the public sector pay policy, that does have an impact on staff in terms of how the trade unions negotiate. So there's various different things, but as an organisation, ScotRail Trains Limited hasn't really changed too much.
Okay. Thank you. And then my final question is to Kevin Lindsay. You might want to reflect on what experiences you've seen as different over the last year in particular, but obviously, the publication of a vision for Scotland's railways has been a very important contribution to the future about what Scotland's railway could be or should be. We don't have time today to go through all of that, but you might want to reflect very briefly on where we are just now over the last year, but also what you see happening with the vision for Scotland's railway, and any engagement you've had over the last year on that with the Scottish Government would be helpful.
The first thing I would say has changed is the improvement in industrial relations. Under Abellio, it was a 1970s them and us really conflicted behaviour from the management, in our opinion, and it led to all sorts of disputes. Our own union, we've never been in strike in Scotland since 2002. And I can't say that about England and Wales. It doesn't seem a week go by we were not in dispute. So there's been significant improvements in industrial relations. I just want to go back slightly, because you asked Robert about what can we learn from elsewhere. Well, integrated ticketing, I think, is a must. I get the tram at the bottom of Leith Walk, come up to Edinburgh Waverley, get the train to Glasgow and then go on the underground. I'm dealing with three separate companies. Surely it can't be beyond us as a nation to produce an integrated ticket. We could use just tap and go, buy it online or buy it in a booking office. That's for me, is an easy fix for us. And surprise, surprise, that leads us nicely, because that was part of one of the things we put in to the Vision for Scotland Railways. The Vision for Scotland Railways, we see it as a talking document. We don't think it's the panacea. It's got all the answers. The idea behind it was to start a debate. What sort of railway do we want in Scotland? Do we want a cheap railway with hardly any trains, or do we want a railway which is there for the people? A railway has to be accessible, it has to be affordable, has to be reliable, and it has to be safe. At this moment in time, we're not quite hitting the targets on all of that. My big bugbear are the railway just now. We run high-speed trains, the old intercity 125s. Glasgow's introducing a low-emission zone from the 1st of June. Yeah, we're going to have 18 trains a day with these heavy polluting trains coming into Glasgow Queen Street. They're going to be more polluting than any 1995 bus, lorry or car. Yeah, we're running these trains in. So there has to be a joined-up policy in what we're talking about when it comes to green policies as well. So I could go on genuinely for hours when it comes to the Vision for Scotland Railways, whether it's developing apprenticeships, whether it's bringing in more reliable trains. I always go on about the ticketing. The ticketing is probably the key part of it. And I'm delighted that the Scottish Government listened to us when we campaigned hard to scrapping peak fares. I've always saw that as a tax on workers, and I've never understood why there was peak fares there. Peak fares was always used to reduce people for going on trains in the mornings. Well, surely now we want people on trains to come back into our city centres and towns so they can start spending money in our towns and cities, and then it grows our economy.
Kevin, just on ticketing, we are going to come to that subject later. It's obviously passionate for you, so you'll get a chance to come in on that later.
I'm happy we move on.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. The next questions then come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning. My question's for Robert initially. Transport Focus is arguing for a creation of a ScotRail challenge group. Now, I realise that there is a ScotRail stakeholder panel in place just now. Can you explain what the difference is between the two and what you would like out of a challenge group?
Just now, ScotRail has a stakeholder panel. It's basically an advisory panel. Gets an agenda from ScotRail, comments on their plans, etc. What we see in other monopolies and other industries is a more challenge panel, a more user channels panel that looks at the actual business plans, can actually put challenge to the management. And we feel this would be a step forward now that ScotRail is in public ownership, that the passenger groups and other groups could have more of an insight and more of a challenging it and making sure that the sense of the direction of ScotRail as a business is channelled towards what the passengers and potential passengers actually want going forward. Other industries such as utilities, etc., have had challenge panels that seems to be a success, and good business engagement and all our insight reflects getting the consumer voice embedded into the process. And at the start of this new journey with ScotRail, this would be an opportunity to get the consumer voice embedded in the decision-making processes. You can have better consultation regarding timetables, over the fare structures, over the direction of the business. We think a better voice for consumers is important at this time in Scotland. Thank you.
So you think it would be heard more rather than...
Yeah, it would be heard more rather than be an advisory voice, and more embedded in the... Not to actually make the decisions, but making sure that before the final decisions are actually made, that the consumer voice has been not only been heard, but been listened to and where appropriate, acted upon to get a better service for customers.
OK. I have another question, but do you want me to take it later on?
I think that logically fits in. So we go to Monica with her question now. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. And I'll refer to my... register of interest as I'm on the voluntary side, as I'm a member of the RMT parliamentary group, and I'm also a member of Unite the Union, which I'll mention because a vision for Scotland Railways has been mentioned, and Unite are one of the co-authors. I might have a question on that. So yeah, I wanted to start off by asking our panel today, and good morning to you all, whether you have a view on how the new institutional arrangements for the provision of ScotRail services are working, and to ask, are the roles and lines of communication between Scottish ministers, Transport Scotland, Scottish Rail Holdings and ScotRail Trains sufficiently clear and well understood to ensure the focus remains on current and future service delivery? And if they're not, then how could things be improved? I'll maybe just start with Mick and come along the table, if that's okay.
I'm certainly not clear on the setup, Monica, if I'm honest. It's quite confusing. You know, like you say, ScotRail Holdings, Transport Scotland, you know, like you say, the ScotRail Board, you know, the Transport Secretary. It's really confusing for all the unions to actually follow what's to be put in place as far as Scotland's railway is concerned. We are very, very keen to have a good, positive working relationship with all parties. But if I'm brutally honest, Monica, it's quite hard to actually follow.
Mm-hmm. And how do you think that could be improved then? Because we're also keen to see if there's lessons that could be learned for other organisations that might want to sort of follow this model. So how could that be simplified?
Well, less bureaucracy, if I'm honest, you know, and a more focus on Scotland's railway. You know, we should be focusing and spending our energies and time on running Scotland's railway. As Kevin said earlier, you know, industrial relations was an issue previously. We've now got rid of the bullies, and we have a good working relationship with the Chief Executive Officer and other senior managers within Scotland's Railway. Another good example is the pay side. The pay side for the majority of the unions were on a good track so far as the pay side is concerned. And if you compare that from last year and the debacle we actually had to go through last year, we're on a better footing this time round.
OK, thank you for that. Gary?
OK, so I'll explain this as best I can. So you have ScotRail Trains Limited, then you have Scottish Rail Holdings Company, which is the parent company. You also have a Transport Scotland sponsor who reports in, as far as I understand, to the Strategic Rail Board, which is part of Transport Scotland. And you also have the Minister. So I think that's about four, maybe five layers going up and down and maybe across. In addition to that, you also have the ScotRail Network Rail Alliance Board, which sits somewhere in that, at which level I'm not particularly sure. So the roles and responsibilities, it's my understanding that the roles and responsibilities are not entirely clear. I think there's some information out there, which is that ScotRail Trains are supposed to lead on the strategic direction of the business in line with the Scottish Government objectives. The holding company are there to oversee that. The sponsor and Transport Scotland via the Strategic Rail Board are there to make sure that the sponsors act inappropriately and the Minister reports into that. But if it sounds overly complicated, it's probably because it is. So there's quite a few cogs there. I don't believe that they're working quite harmoniously at the moment because of the lack of sort of clarity around roles and responsibilities. But it is a year. These sorts of things take some time to bed in. And I would point out that maybe that structure is not too distant from what you had under Abellio and FIRST, because you would have had the subsidiary, the parent company, they reported into a company in Holland, and you would have had the Scottish Government involvement. So those layers are probably somewhat broadly reflective of what has gone previously. But because it's a sort of new... I don't think the railway's been in public hands in Scotland for 20, 30 years. So it's a new methodology, new system of working. So I say give it a wee bit of time to bed in, but it does seem to me overly complicated. So I would just say, look, are the roles and responsibilities clear to the people that are involved in it? And are there too many cogs in the machine, as it were? But I don't know if now is the right time to judge it.
Gary, I think it's a very interesting point that you've made there, and I'd be interested to hear Kevin and Robert report on it. I struggled over the weekend to try and understand who reported to who on which level, and I still wasn't any clearer having spent 3 days at it. And I suppose I'm supposed to be in the know in this Parliament about what's going on, but it was opaque and confusing to me. So thank you for trying to explain it. I'm not sure I'm any clearer, but
yeah.
It's not a criticism of you, it's a criticism of the system. Kevin.
I don't think I'm going to make it any clearer for you, because I think you've got a Cabinet Secretary at the top, you've then got a Transport Minister, you've then got Transport Scotland, then you've got SRH. So that bit's all quite clear. But the whole point of setting up SRH was to be arm's length. I'm just not convinced that the Minister of Transport Scotland or the Cab Secretary, well, to be fair, the Cab Secretary definitely arm's length, wants nothing to do with railways, doesn't want to touch it. Transport Minister, I think, still finding his brief, so we'll see. I've dealt with 14 different Transport Ministers from three different political parties since the conception or the reopening, depending on your argument on that, of this building on the Scottish Parliament. So I've dealt with them all, and they all have their own ways of dealing with stuff. I look forward to working with Kevin Stewart, see how he works it. If I then take the SRH's board, the SRH's board has went through several changes already. We've seen the Chief Executive resign or pushed because of political interference or not political interference. I think that needs clarity. We've then also got underneath the SRH, we've got ScotRail's board, but now we've also got a new board coming in as well for the Caledonian Sleeper. And then we've got a side board, the ScotRail Alliance, with the Managing Director of Scotland Railways, Alex Hines. And Alex will come and tell you today what his role is. He very kindly sent me a diagram to explain where he sat within Scotland Railways. And, Convener, I agree with you. I'm still no clearer on what the role of the Managing Director of Scotland Railways is, because we've got a Chief Operating Officer for ScotRail Railways. We've got a Chief Operator, a Managing Director for the Caledonian Sleeper. We've got a Chief Executive and a Chair of SRH. There seems to be an awful lot of people... I nearly said their noses in the trough, but that would be kindly a bit unfair. An awful lot of people getting paid six-figure salaries for being in senior positions, some for 2 days a week, some for 1 day a week, some for 3 days a week. I think there needs to be clarity. I think there has to be... I think if we're going to be true what we want, the government sets policy, SRH gets on with it, and the ScotRail board, ScotRail board should get on with it. I really don't see why the Caledonian Sleeper's an add-on. It should be put back into... ScotRail, and again, there's a saving doing that instantly by doing that. So I think Gary's right. Early days is confusion, but we can streamline this a lot more.
I think you've all done really well at talking us through that. I suppose just very briefly, Kevin, before we move to Robert, is if it is overly complex at the moment and it could be streamlined to get more clarity, what could also be done to just improve, you know, lines of accountability, you know, in terms of where responsibility lies, and also are things transparent enough? Because I'm keen to hear what it looks like from a public perspective.
I think transparency is a huge issue. The minutes get published from various boards and that, but as always, a lot of things can be heavily redacted, so there is issues around transparency. I think we really, as a parliament, or as people, we need to set out what we want from the railways, and that would be in political parties' manifestos. Whatever party wins, that becomes the policy. The ministers and the cabinet should set that and give the deal. Well, that's what you have to deliver to SRH, and let them go on with it. I appreciate sometimes that ministers or MSPs will raise issues around their constituencies or issues and that. Again, that's acceptable, but the professionals in the railway are the railway people, and you should, if you're employing people on six-figure salaries, you've got to let them do the job. And so I would suggest that we have a board, gets on with the job. ScotRail reports in, Caledonian Sleeper will report in initially, but I hope that we move ScotRail's railways back into one company, because there is no need for two separate boards and two separate companies. And we're delighted that the Scottish Government have taken or made steps to bring the railway back into public ownership. But Abellio still run the payroll for ScotRail. We still pay private operating companies for the rolling stock. The sleepers is even more complicated, because the only things that have been nationalised are the train managers, the sleeper hosts, and the name. Everything else is in private hands. So we need to look at all of these functions. How much is that costing us as taxpayers? And what do we really want to do about that going forward? So, again, I go off in a direction, because they're all interconnected, but we need an overall strategy, and it has to be very clear what we're looking at.
Oh, very helpful. Thank you. Robert?
Yeah, I'll not repeat what's been said, but it is a complicated structure. We have good working relationships with all the bodies, I would like to think. But we've also sat down with passengers and various focus groups, not just on rail and bus, because there's various things in the bus about franchising, partnerships, etc., public-private. And we go through the structure of the rail industry, we go through the structure of the bus industry. And about halfway through, passengers just shake their head and go, whatever the structure is, as a consumer, can it just work so that it's easy to use and that it's punctual and reliable? Now, a good thing about the recently published high-level output specification by Scottish Ministers and Transport Scotland is we hope it has some improvement, because it's now Network Rails to establish and operate with ScotRail Trains Limited, a joint Scotland-based timetabling team, deliver all activity in the Scottish Rail network. We hope that has a more joined-up approach, because at the end of the day, that's what passengers buy their ticket for, a timetable that is deliverable and is punctual and reliable. So hopefully that will ensure. And also in the high-level output specification, going back to outputs, there's targets in there that both ScotRail and Caledonian Sleeper have to meet on passenger satisfaction. So we're content to a certain degree, regardless of the structure, that there'll be better timetable delivery. Hopefully it's on paper, we'll see the product, but there's actually targets to be made in delivering levels of passenger satisfaction and delivering punctuality 92.5% as well, which will be an improvement on today. So we're looking at those outputs, and that's what passengers will be focused on, rather than the structures as outputs as a consumer. Thank you.
Thank you. Back to you, Kimberly.
Thanks very much, Monica, and thank you all for your valiant efforts in explaining all of that. Mark, I think the next questions are yours.
So the impression I'm getting this morning, then, is that industrial relations have improved a bit over the last year. As you're saying, Mick, you know, you got rid of the bullies, I think you said. Has it made a difference having a union representative on Scottish Rail Holdings?
Yes. We, as the four railway unions, agreed to collectively that we would actually support Ros Foy from the STEC. And Ros obviously does a job for the four rail unions. And I think it's right that Ros should be there. There is an issue in relation to the Caledonian sleeper from the 25th of June. Should Ros represent ScotRail and the sleeper, or should there be a separate union representative on the ScotRail Holdings representing the sleeper? Because they are two different organisations, and as Kevin rightly says, you know, there should be one organisation so far as Scotland's railway is concerned. But industrial relations have dramatically improved, of which we actually welcome good industrial relations. Because you have good industrial relations, then there is no way to dispute. Cards on the table with RMT, I've never ever hesitated from issuing the ballot papers if there's an issue that we feel strongly about, and we will continue to actually issue the ballot papers if we feel strongly about anyone that's actually facing a disciplinary, if we feel that it's a miscarriage of justice, and we need to take action in order to defend our member or membership. But certainly industrial relations are good and something we actually welcome. Mm-hmm.
Gary Kevin, does that model of union representation, has it worked?
What I would say is that industrial relations have improved since the move into public ownership, but there are still issues. I think chief among them is the public sector pay policy issue. That's probably the one thing that has led to more disruption than anything else since the move into public ownership. I think Kevin mentioned transparency. I also think that has improved somewhat, but there are still issues with transparency and openness from ScotRail Trains Limited. So I'd say work in progress, really. It's not really where I would like to see it, but I have noticed a move in the right direction. But until the issue of public sector pay policy is resolved, that potentially it's been relatively without massive contention over the past 2 years. There have been disputes, but I think if the government in the day was slightly different and took a different approach to pay, it could, for future years, create a massive flashpoint further down the line. So it does need to be looked at. Our view is that we shouldn't be restricted in our collective bargaining. We should be able to negotiate freely and openly with an employer, whether that's ScotRail Trains Limited or anyone else. But that does have the potential to cause issues in the future.
Yeah, thanks.
And as I said earlier about industrial relations, I think they've improved significantly. I was just had a look at my notes there. IR's improved, but ScotRail are on their third HR director since nationalisation. So maybe not having an HR director's helped us in that. But again, maybe I'm being a bit flippant. But again, I think there's got to be some praise given to the ScotRail board. I think that they've taken them in a different direction. They've wanted to engage with us, and they've tried to put out the fires before they've started. So that's got to be welcome. The public sector pay policy, we said from the outset during all the TUPE meetings and that, if the Scottish Government go down this line and try to implement public sector pay policy on the rail trade unions, then you'll find yourselves in dispute. I didn't need a crystal ball to see that, but we've always been willing to negotiate. We're always willing. We've been modernised, Eisen since Stevenson's rocket. We're always willing to sit down and do deals and move things forward. To then suddenly get told that's what you're getting, there is no negotiations in it, that can't work with us. We'll not accept it, and it'll lead to conflict. We do not want to stop trains. We want to run trains. We want to get as many passengers on as possible. I'm delighted just now ScotRail performance is doing great. I'm delighted that ScotRail's passenger numbers are over 200,000 a day now. And the revenue in ScotRail, and I'm sure the Chief Operating Officer and those coming in behind us will explain how high the revenue is just now, but it is running 10, 12% above targets. That's all got to be welcome, but that's all based on good industrial relations. So we need to build on where we are just now, get some of the stuff on board. The key part of all of this is we can never forget the passengers. The passengers are key to this, and we need to get more of them back into the railway. Mm-hmm. So good IR is key to it. The structure, it helps it. Having a trade union voice on the board, I think, is helpful as well. But I just think that it's better working relations within ScotRail and the trade union officials has certainly delivered.
OK. That's good to hear.
Thanks. We'll go to Jackie Dunbar next.
Thank you.
To go back to Kevin just now, I was actually going to address this to Mick, so I might come back to you, Mick, as well. You were speaking about the pay for rail staff, and you said that it won't work putting the rail staff onto the Scottish Government pay policy. Can you explain why it won't work? You know, and why do you think the staff, the rail staff, should have the exemption? I know you said it won't work, but can you explain why it won't?
I believe in free collective bargaining, and so that's the fundamental part of it. If I go to a negotiation, there has to be a negotiation. I've got to be able to give and take, and it's got to go both ways. So if I walk in, it's a fait accompli. That's what you're getting, because the Minister says there is zero point in me being in there, and if the offer isn't high enough, then I can just miss out on negotiations, go straight to industrial action. So I think that we sought advice, and it was Alex Rowley, MSP, who wrote to Scottish Parliament's Information Centre seeking clarity on where ScotRail sat, and Spice's advice was in direct contradiction to the advice that we got from the Scottish Government. So I've shared it with Kevin Stewart, I shared it with Jenny Gilroof. I've got two different letters back from Jenny and from Kevin on their version of what took place, and it's not very clear what they're saying other than we're following Scottish Government policy. What Spice said to us, that there's nothing to... that ScotRail Railways Holdings sits outside. However, the directors of that business must be aware of Scottish Government policy on public sector pay, which is different from an instruction you will follow public sector pay. The Scottish Government, or the Scottish Government's transport ministers, don't accept that. So I think there needs to be some sort of clarity within this building, who's right and who's wrong. But what we've had for the last 2 years is public sector pay being enforced on us. And then secondly, we've had then negotiations taking place where we've came up with a form of words which takes us away from public sector pay to then do a deal. So again, if we're sticking to public sector pay, that we're doing deals. That doesn't then mean that the Scottish, well, in my opinion then, the Scottish Government's interpretation of public sector pay doesn't sit, whereas Spice's advice would say fit perfectly, you must take an ISIS off the public sector pay, but still negotiate.
Sorry, can I just clarify this, because I'm a little bit confused now. Mm. Is in the last year of the franchise, when it was going to be nationalised, Abellio could make decisions on wages, providing they were approved by the Scottish Government. They couldn't make a decision without approval from the Transport Minister, because that was part of the agreement. Yes. What you're suggesting to me, sorry, just so I understand this, is that now any pay rises have to be approved by the Scottish Government, although the decision is made by an arm's length company. Is that what you're saying?
Well, yes, but you've got to remember, it's got to jump through all the hoops. So we meet with SRT, who report to SRH, who report to TS, who reports to the Transport Minister, who reports to the Cab Secretary. Right? That's why we ended up in the carry-on we had last year, because we were jumping through every one of the hoops to get there. And that's how we finally got there last year. This year it's been a lot more smoother. I don't know if SRT have had authority from the various different ones above, but we have done a deal this year, which is out to a referendum of our members, but it's above public sector pay. So then that does not tie in to the letter I've received from the Scottish Government saying you will stick to public sector pay, where that falls into where I'm saying it falls into the advice that Spice gave us through Alex Rowley. I'm okay. Happy to provide the briefing papers that we got.
I think it would be useful just for the committee to understand it. Sorry, Jackie, I jumped in on your question.
Thank you. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth here. I'm trying to understand. So you're saying that just now you think it should be exempted because of the confusion and you need more clarity. And I'm not saying that if you got more clarity, you would automatically go for it. I'm not suggesting that, but that is one of the main reasons just now why you don't think it should be part of the same pay policy. Or am I misinterpreting you?
I don't believe we should be part of public sector policy, because it's meant to be ScotRail's an arm's length company. It's not like the civil servants in the building here, which are direct employees of the Scottish Government. So Scottish Water is already sits outside. Caledonian McBrain sits outside. So why are ScotRail's railways, or ScotRail being brought in? It To me, it doesn't make sense. It should never have been went in that direction. They were warned at the start, repeatedly warned that this would just end in conflict if you try to impose public sector pay. I'm not saying we'll get better deals, but I strongly believe in free collective bargaining. That's the agreement we signed up with every rail company. It's our procedure agreement. They sign it, we sign it, and then we move forward. You don't always have to agree, but you've got to set the rules how you play it. You can't have somebody who's never signed any agreement saying, by the way, that's the new rules, because it's never going to sit with trade unionists.
Thank you. That really does make more sense to me now. Mick, would you like to add anything?
It's a shambles, if I'm honest. You know, you see, we've never agreed, as Kevin rightly says, but we've never agreed with the public sector pay policy. We certainly feel, all the unions feel, that it's a direct interference in the free collective bargaining, and we would obviously want to see the public sector rate pay policy be removed and allow the unions to bargain freely. And as Kevin rightly says, you know, it's a Caledonian McBrain. You know, let's say the teachers, the firefighters, they're not governed by the public sector pay. And it's an interesting one, the Caledonian McBrain one. You know, let's say, I think last year they got 7.2% there or there, but about way beyond the 5% of the public sector pay policy. Having said that, as Kevin rightly says, we've actually done a deal this year, and it's not just about pay, it's about terms and conditions also. And we've advocated and successfully negotiated a better deal for low paid workers, which is a key policy within my trade union. So we've done a deal which is hopefully acceptable to our members. It's in the process of going to a referendum ballot, and that ballot result will be known very, very shortly. But certainly the public sector pay policy is a no-go as far as RMT and my other rail unions colleagues are concerned.
OK, thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. Go to Mark Ruskell. Mark. Yeah.
So you mentioned the future ticket offices already and the uncertainty there over government's intention. What do you see as the future for ticket offices? Is it about maintaining the existing service forever? Is it about introducing change? And what would that change look like? Yep.
OK, so we're obviously opposed to any talk of, let's say, closing ticket offices. You know, I mentioned earlier about the antisocial weight behaviour issue. We certainly believe that the ticket office issue and the antisocial behaviour are inextricably linked, you know, because the antisocial behaviour and assaults on passengers and staff is on the increase. And if you take into account, let's say, the most vulnerable people within society who are very, very reluctant to actually use Scotland's railway because the antisocial behaviour issue is out of control. And we've heard on the countless occasion that Scotland's railway is open for all. It can't be open for all if the issue of antisocial behaviour is getting worse, and it is getting worse. And I don't want to be the one to turn round and say to the Transport Secretary or the Chief Executive Officer of Scotland's Trains, I told you so, that someone's now lost their life as a result of antisocial weight behaviour. I don't want to repeat myself in terms of the legislation side, you know, let's say the football grounds and the shopping centres. Why can't we actually ban those who are actually found guilty? And I would even go a step further. I would actually name and shame those people who have actually been found guilty of assaults and antisocial behaviour within Scotland's railway.
OK, Robert, what's the passenger view on ticket offices in the future?
Passengers want to have as I keep repeating, a visible staff presence. The problem, we had 1,500 responses from passengers over the ticket office consultation. A lot of them was about the act of buying a ticket, about the suitability of ticket vending machines as well, selling the full range of tickets and be easy to use. It was about availability of waiting rooms, toilet facilities at stations if there's no staff. I was concerned, as Mick has mentioned, about antisocial behaviour and the personal security of passengers. It was about accessibility for passengers with additional needs. I called a whole range of issues are wrapped up there to do with a station, but the actual consultation process only looks at the simple act of buying a ticket. Mm-hmm. What the ticket and settlement agreement governs is a regulatory process that governs changes to ticket offices, and it only looks at the simple act of buying a ticket retailing. But when we go out to ask passengers to review, they comment on a whole range of staffing issues at a station. You know, from our point of view, it would be far better if the regulation actually shifted from ticket office opening hours and moved to station staffing hours.
Okay.
That would be better. That gives the railways more options to redeploy staff and also gives passengers more protection and enforcement than they have today.
Right.
The actual process only looks at retailing
so
and isolation.
Maybe they're just misnamed. They're not ticket offices, they're station offices. Really.
Yeah,
that,
yeah.
That maybe gives a sense
when we ask
of where
passengers their views, they come back in the whole range of the station issues, not just the retailing aspects.
Yep.
And the only way we've got to challenge that, although we can make recommendations, as we have, and I've referenced it in our written evidence, and they're non-binding recommendations, the only way we can change the retailing, if they sell 12 tickets or less in an hour, they can change the station opening times, basically. Right. It's not to deal with the whole station aspect, it's just retailing. And we think that's a flaw in the regulatory process,
okay.
But our hands are tied by that.
Yeah, Gary, do you want to add something?
Yeah. Robert sort of hit on it a bit there. Yes, the ticketing system is massively complex, and going up to buy a ticket is probably the easiest way to get the cheapest ticket available. I don't think you can get it from TVMs. Certainly more of the complex tickets, you wouldn't be able to get them any cheaper than a ticket office. They know the best option for you, but it's really crucial to note that booking offices, the people that work there, they don't just sell tickets. They do a whole range of other activities, station maintenance. They make sure that the station's clean and tidy, gritted. They make sure that any defects are reported. They provide passenger assist to get people on and off trains. Some stations do dispatch as well. Staff are called station grades. There's a separate grade which is travel shop, which is really dedicated to selling tickets and selling tickets alone. That's in the more major stations, but in the suburban stations, largely it's the station grades who do a lot of the work. They don't just sit behind the desk and sell tickets. It's not just a retail role. The proposal on the table looked at closing three booking offices, but altering the opening and closing times for the remainder if they don't sell these 12 tickets. What that would effectively do is to take a booking office that might be open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and to shut it for a large proportion of the day and just to keep it staffed at the busiest period. That takes bodies out of the railway, and for all the reasons that Mick's identified with antisocial behaviour and customer service, we don't think it's a good idea. You need to have staff at the stations, but it is crucial to note that they don't just sell tickets. They already do the range of activities which the passengers want to see happen, and it would be a mistake to effectively take the staff out of those stations and to redeploy them to a barrier in central station or somewhere similar.
Mm-hmm. I'm content to move on unless you've got something you want to add to that, Kevin.
Yep. I mean, what percentage of tickets are bought online? I mean, how many people actually buy it at the station compared to those people who go onto Trainline and buy tickets or whatever the way of doing it is? Do you know the answer to that?
Online is more prevalent now by either digital or mobile technology. In the ScotRail consultation, Joe Maguire, Alex Hines will probably give you a more definite answer, but from 1990s, the start of privatisation, ticket office sales have fallen year on year from about 40% down to under 20%.
I mean, I'm not disputing the comments anyone's made about security and looking after railway stations. I'm just interested to know how many people actually buy tickets at a station rather than doing it online and using the technology that we have.
Not many people actually buy at the actual booking offices, but as as Gary rightly says, it's not just about selling the tickets. There's other productive activities that rail staff give.
And Mick, I very much made that point. It's not, I understand it's not just about tickets, but I was just interested in the proportion of tickets. So it might be that they're repurposed rather than necessarily selling tickets, if the importance of keeping people there.
Right. Sorry. Yes. But they already do the work outside of just selling tickets, so I don't know if they need to be repurposed. It's about when they're at the station. The proposal was to take them out of the station at certain times, yeah, if they're not selling tickets. They already do the work outside of just sitting and selling tickets.
I very much take that point. Going to move on to the next question, which comes from Monica. Monica.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I mean, I'm quite concerned listening to colleagues on the panel, particularly what Mick has said about, you know, not wanting to be saying to future ministers, you know, told you so, that someone has lost their lives, you know, on Scotland's railways due to antisocial behaviour. But I was looking back on a previous session when Jenny Gilruth was here and officials from government, and these issues were raised about the trends that we were seeing, the limitations on the British Transport Police, and some of the particular concerns about the safety of women and girls on trains and at stations. So this was supposed to be looked at as part of a national conversation. I just want to ask you if you can give an update on that, what engagement has happened. And earlier on you talked about, you know, people are not going to use the trains if they believe that antisocial behaviour is out of control. Is it already out of control, Mick?
Obviously, yes. It's getting worse, in my view, because we actually receive, as a trade union, continuous updates from our members and our representatives in terms of antisocial behaviour and assaults. There's a lot of talk about, like, say, what we actually intend doing to actually address antisocial behaviour. I'm not suggesting, and none of the rail unions are suggesting, that we'll ever eradicate antisocial behaviour, but antisocial behaviour has become a magnet for those people who use Scotland's railway in order to actually cause absolute havoc. Now, there's not enough British Transport Police. You know, I think there's something in the region of 56 British Transport Police. We're not suggesting that British Transport Police have the resources to be on every train, but what we actually need, we need more of a visual presence of the British Transport Police on the actual train. ScotRail will probably say that we have safe travel team personnel, which we do, which again we actually welcome, because it gives a reassurance to the train driver and the train guard when using the Scotland's railway. The issue is getting worse, Monica, I've got to say that. And what we actually need is we need a joined-up approach from all parties, all stakeholders, in order to address this legislation, in order to address this issue. And we need probably a change in the legislation in order to actually give the police more power, because the British Transport Police have told us on countless occasions, when it comes to the juveniles, then they take them back to their parents, and within the space of an hour, 2 hours, the same juveniles are back at the train station, causing absolute havoc. So we need legislation in order to ensure that those responsible are actually dealt with robustly.
So there's a government summit due to happen looking at violence in schools and around antisocial behaviour involving young people. Does the focus need to go beyond schools to look at what's happening in the wider community?
Absolutely. Absolutely. 100%. We need to have a joined-up approach. You know, my understanding is the approach when it comes to Scotland's schools from a ScotRail perspective, right, is limited. You know, I don't think there's enough engagement with the schools, with the communities, when it comes to young people within Scotland. And I think there needs to be a better approach when it comes to engaging with the schools.
Thanks, Mick.
And just lastly, Monica, the national conversation, a lot of promises, but delivered nothing.
I wasn't sure if I'd missed the national conversation or not, so I was hoping you guys might be able to update us. And on that, I know that Jenny Gilruth did say quite a lot about the safety of women and girls for the public and for staff. So I don't know if Gary and Kevin can maybe provide any update on that. But the last, also wrapped up in that, what's morale like for staff just now?
Oh, sorry. The last time we met with Jenny Gilruth, I think she advised that the consultation on women's safety had done some work, and there was a report which has been published, I believe, and the national conversation has always been around in the background, but we received a letter, I believe, from Kevin Stewart, which the new minister, which outlined that the national conversation would take place in the summer. So we anticipate what we have asked for as trade unions is a copy of the terms of reference for the national conversation. Mm-hmm. I think this encompasses the Fair Fares review, as far as we understand. And there will no doubt be a wider public consultation on women's safety. I think the part, the piece of work that's already been done was a closed consultation, more of a research project, but did consult with various different stakeholders. But there has, as far as I understand, been no wider public consultation on women's safety. And I think that, as far as I understand, the consultation, the national consultation on women's safety, national consultation on fair fares, and the national conversation are all rolled into one. And the national conversation is more what sort of railway we would like to see running, which would encompass issues around booking offices as well. That's all set scheduled to run in the summer of this year, as far as I understand. But from a trade union point of view, we've asked for more information about the terms of reference, specific timelines, etc. Mm-hmm. But with the change of minister, I think that's sort of held that up. Okay.
A really helpful update. I'm not sure if we've been told about that as a committee, but that's really helpful.
Just quickly, national conversation, Gary's covered. On the antisocial behaviour, I raised with the British Transport Police and asked a question, how many people have been arrested, charged or prosecuted for pulling the PASCOM? You see, that every one of us use the train, you see it, you will be fined if you pull the PASCOM. PASCOMs are pulled day in, day out, across Scotland's railways. Not one person has ever been charged, prosecuted or fined for doing that. British Transport Police have given us an assurance they will now treat that as a crime that they'll have to deal with. But the reason why I always raise it is because once that train gets stopped and disrupts every person's journey on that train, it then brings the people who have pulled the PASCOM into direct conflict with the driver or the guard, who then has to reset it. And that then generally leads to issues around them with their vaping, feet on the seats, drinking, not having a ticket, spitting on, assaulting. So it's the pulling of the PASCOM, the minor issue, which is the flare-up point for the rest of it. And another one that happens regularly and nobody's ever been prosecuted for is letting off the fire extinguishers on trains. It's happening frequently. Again, disrupts the travel for the majority of people on that train. Nobody's ever been prosecuted for that. But my greatest concern, though, is what if we end up with a fire on a train and then somebody has let off a fire extinguisher and that could lead to deaths. Again, it's a big probability, but there's still that probability there. I've asked ScotRail for an updated risk assessment on it because it's an ongoing issue. So it's the low-level antisocial behaviour which is a trigger point for the bigger antisocial behaviour. And one other thing, final point I would make is that not every train has two members of staff on it. A lot of the trains in the Strathclyde area can have one member of staff. ScotRail's agreement with Scottish Rail Holdings is that they must roster a second person on every train. That doesn't guarantee you a second person on every train. So the driver could be at the front, not knowing what's going on behind, all sorts of issues. That affects accessibility for people with disabilities, safety for women, children, and the general public. So we've been pushing for a long, long time to make it a compulsory that a train can run without two people on it, a driver and another member of staff, because we want to make the railway as safe as possible.
Safety is absolutely critical. So, yeah, I'll let Gary back in and I'll have to hand back to Convener. Yeah, sorry, Monica. Watching the clock.
There was just two things. So, from what I understand, there's been around a 20-25% reduction in BTP officers in Scotland since 2014. That has had an impact in terms of antisocial behaviour. And also the other thing potentially to look at, we've had discussions about banning orders previously. The other thing potentially to look at is something similar to Section 156 of the Police Crime and Sentencing Bill, I believe, which looks at assaults on those providing a public service is an aggregating factor in sentencing. So that might deter people from actually assaults on public transport workers. That's legislation south of the border. It's perhaps something that could be looked at here.
Thank you.
I'm going to wrestle this back to try and let Liam in, who's been waiting very patiently. So, Liam, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Mick Hogg, I'll come to you first, please, because your submissions, the submissions of the RMT, highlight the need for considerable investment in Scottish Rail and demands an increase in that investment, and rightly, in my view, flags the Carmarthen tragedy, which I'll return to in a second. Given Robert Sampson's comments earlier about ticket prices, do you think, Mick Hogg, that that investment should come from the Scottish Government now that it owns Scotland's railway, and if so, from where should it draw that increase in funding?
I'm not really too fussed where the actual investment comes from, because what's came over loud and clear is that Scotland needs a significant investment in Scotland's railway. We've actually got a Victorian infrastructure when it comes to Scotland's railway, and what we actually need is investment, and we actually need more jobs. What's been talked about is less investment when we come out of CP6 and we approach CP7. Less investment, less jobs, and if we're absolutely serious about, like, say, ensuring that there is not another railway disaster in terms of Carmarthen, Stonehaven, then we need to learn the lessons, because if we don't learn the lessons, then there will be other real disasters in Scotland. And let me finish on this note. We have nothing to actually thank the pandemic for, but if it wasn't for the pandemic, then I'm absolutely convinced there would have been a lot more than three people losing their life, because that train and that eventful day would have been jam-packed, and we would have ended up with hundreds of people losing their lives, and bet your bottom dollar a lot of heads would have actually rolled as a result.
And I'll stay with you, Mick Hogg, and I'll stay with the tragedy at Carmarthen. So this was this awful event in 2020 near Stonehaven, and just last week it was revealed that only 2 of the 20 recommended actions have been taken following that tragedy. Now that the Scottish Government owns the railway, do you feel that the Scottish Government is sufficiently looking at the new risks from, for example, the climate emergency that concerns this committee, and are its budget decisions appropriate in your view when 18 actions out of the 20 remain untaken?
Well, my quick, simple answer is no. Let's say two recommendations that have actually been taken forward out of a total of 20 is an absolute scandal, as far as I'm concerned. The rail unions and the families who have actually lost loved ones will absolutely be appalled in terms of the recommendations that have been addressed so far. And it has all the hallmarks, all the hallmarks of another potential, sadly, accident happening again if we actually don't learn the lessons of the actual railway accident. We need the action, and we need those 20 recommendations to actually be addressed. And what we don't need is less investment and less jobs in our maintenance. You know, we need more investment and more jobs in order to ensure we're actually running a safe railway. You know, and Kevin might well touch on this issue in terms of the HST trains. The HST trains are 50-year-old trains, and it's an absolute joke, an absolute nonsense that we're actually using 50-year-old trains. And the managing director of the Scott Railway Alliance has quoted on many occasions that the best railway that Scotland's ever had. It's the worst railway that Scotland's ever had. And what we actually need is more investment. And what we don't need is 50-year-old trains.
Kevin Lindsay, perhaps you'd like to take that point on the HSTs running up to Aberdeen.
Can I just go back? Sure. The RAIB recommendations are 20. The industry is working through them. So it's not unusual at this stage, a year after it, to only have two ticked off. So the industry will work through them. There's working groups on dealing with them. There's national groups and there's also Scottish groups dealing with that. So 2 out of 20 seems terrible, but it's not unusual. Whether that's acceptable is another argument, but it's not unusual. So, but I'm sure as an industry, which we all participate in, we'll get through the recommendations. It's whether the Scottish Government implementing the recommendations is the key part of it. On the HSTs, the HST is 47-year-old. It's not fit for purpose. It's the most polluting train in the UK. Why it was allowed to come to Scotland is a question I think needs looked at. Abellio won the franchise bid over National Express. At the time, there was less than 1 percentage point in awarding the franchise. I would like to know why or who within Transport Scotland allowed that decision, because ultimately it was that decision that brought HSTs to Scotland. I genuinely believe that the Carman crash, and it was a crash, and it was caused by failures of Network Rail to maintain the infrastructure, failure of ScotRail to follow their own policies, and I also believe failure of Transport Scotland to protect the people of Scotland by allowing this heritage rolling stock to come to Scotland. We've informed ScotRail, Transport Scotland and various different transport ministers over 2 years ago that we were going to boycott them from the 12th of August this year unless we saw significant improvements in the HSTs. At this moment in time, we've not received enough information on what improvements are going to be, and as such, we're looking to boycott these trains come the 12th of August. We've got further meetings with the Carman HST Steering Group, which I participate in, and we'll let it run its course, but the likelihood come the 12th of August, ASLIF will instruct all our members not to touch these trains based on their crashworthiness. The crashworthiness of these trains are from the 1970s. They do not meet modern standards. They're a fibreglass shell at the front of it with a wooden frame. Who would build a train like that nowadays? You wouldn't do it. And who would want to travel at 125 mile an hour sitting inside that? It's not good enough. These trains should never have been in Scotland. I'd love to know who made that decision. Who thought they were going to give us a modern railway? Sorry, Chair Convener.
No. Kevin, I see and hear your passion, but I have to mix the committee up to make sure they all get their questions. I think you've got one more you want.
One more question, Convener. I'm very grateful for the answer, incidentally. Robert Sampson, I'll come to you finally. The people of the North East were promised £200 million. To invest in rail in 2016 to shave, the intention was to shave 20 minutes off journey times to the Central Belt, which would give better flexibility on the timetables, better experience for the staff and better experience for passengers. Now, I believe only about or just over 1% of that has actually been spent, and the outcomes, of course, haven't actually been delivered yet. So after 1 year of Scottish Government ownership, which doesn't appear to be impacting on the spending of this £200 million. How do you find passengers are feeling about this lack of the 20 minutes being delivered? And is it having an impact on the recovery of our railway? And do you get any sense that this money will be delivered and the 20 minutes shaved?
We haven't any sense of when the money will actually be spent, but as a passenger, one of the top 10 priorities is for quicker journey times, but that's after punctuality, reliability, frequency. So those are the main ones for passengers. But where you would have the impact of quicker journey time is actually on modal shift between Aberdeen and the Central Belt. That would have its greatest impact. That is one of the greater drivers for non-users coming onto the rail network. Existing passengers who use it just now are more interested in how cheap is my ticket? Is it punctual and reliable? is there a good frequency of service? Am I able to get a seat on the train? Those are the main issues. After then it comes to quicker journey times, but in trying to meet other government objectives of getting more people onto public transport, then yes, quicker journey times is definitely a lever that has to be pulled.
So just to be very absolutely clear, if that money was spent, if the 20 minutes was delivered, we could see significant modal shift between Aberdeen and the Central Belt?
You would see some modal shift. I haven't got the actual percentages, but that is one of the main drivers for non-users changing mode is faster journey times.
Very grateful.
Thanks, Liam. And Mark, you're going to have the shortest question to one person.
Thanks. An issue has been raised to me about the illegal migration bill and its effect on transport workers, because it appears that it will effectively require transport workers to assist in Home Office deportations. Is that an issue that your members have raised with you?
Who's that going to?
It's one person only.
Because train drivers are in charge, so we will just refuse to do it full stop and end off. It's an absolute nonsense policy, and to expect a train driver to go back and then start manhandling a person on a train, ridiculous.
Right. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming in this morning. Your passion in the subject has been clear to all. Thank you for the evidence you've given, and thank you for also explaining to me the complex structure of how the whole system works. I'm briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Welcome back, everyone. We're now going to hear from a panel of Scottish train operators. I'm therefore pleased to welcome Alex Hines, the Managing Director of Scotland's Railway, David Lowry, the Chief Executive Officer of Scottish Rail Holdings Limited, Joanne Maguire, the Chief Operating Officer for ScotRail Trains Limited, and Liam Sumpter, the Route Director for Network Rail Scotland. Thank you all for accepting our invitation. And before we begin on the questions, I believe that Alex Hines wished to make a short opening statement on behalf of the panel. And while you're at it, Mr. Hines, could you help me? I was confused and muddled about who does what, who reports to who, as indeed were the unions in our last panel. So perhaps you could take your opening statement briefly to explain that.
Okay, of course. Well, good morning and thank you, convener, and thank you to the committee for giving us the opportunity to set out the work we're doing as Scotland's Railway, that's ScotRail, Network Rail Scotland and Scottish Rail Holdings, to deliver a safe, reliable and green railway that provides value for passengers and taxpayers. From the moment the Scottish Government announced that ScotRail would return to public ownership on the 1st of April last year, a key priority was on ensuring a smooth transition. Scottish Rail Holdings are arm's length from government and responsible for the oversight, governance and stewardship of ScotRail, successfully coordinated the transition from private to public ownership with no disruption to passengers or our staff. That's an achievement of which we are proud because it didn't happen by accident. It took brilliant work across our three organisations, as well as with Transport Scotland, the Scottish Government, our staff, our trade union partners, and our suppliers and more to make that happen. Of course, the first year of public ownership wasn't without its challenges, of course. The industrial action on pay faced initially by ScotRail and then later on with greater impact by Network Rail across the whole of Britain resulted in significant disruption for passengers. But as we sit here today, both disputes are now resolved and ScotRail staff are currently voting on pay deals that have been recommended to them by ASLEF and the RMT, the two trade unions which represent the vast majority of our frontline teams. That's significant progress. But we're also making progress in three other key areas. Passenger numbers are increasing, punctuality is improving, and revenue is growing. But we aren't out of the post-pandemic woods just yet. Travel patterns have changed significantly, but things are heading in the right direction. Getting people out of their cars or encouraging more commuter and leisure travel is vital to supporting the Scottish Government's decarbonisation targets, increasing revenue and reducing government subsidy. Public ownership gives us the opportunity to plan for the long-term future of the railway rather than the life cycle of a seven-year private franchise. The upcoming peak fares trial is a good example of doing things differently under our new ownership arrangements. We're proud of our role in connecting communities, growing Scotland's economy and meeting the country's climate change targets, which align with wider Scottish Government objectives. We believe the first year of public ownership provides us with a strong foundation upon which to build. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Were you going to help me and explain what I found difficult to understand in the last session about who does what?
As we know, the rail industry in Britain is more fragmented than most would like. So essentially, Network Rail runs the infrastructure here in Scotland. ScotRail runs the trains here in Scotland. My role is a joint role. I oversee both ScotRail and Network Rail in Scotland. And Scottish Rail Holdings are responsible for the oversight, governance and stewardship of ScotRail.
So, just so I understand, the Minister for Transport, you report to them?
Not directly. I have a dual reporting line, one to Network Rail and one to ScotRail. So, David chairs the ScotRail board, which is a job for Scottish Rail Holdings. Scottish Rail Holdings is the arm's length company that the Scottish Government established to oversee the newly nationalised ScotRail, and from next month oversee the ownership of Caledonian Sleeper as well.
So your role within that, just so I understand that, is what?
So I'm the Managing Director of ScotRail and I'm the Managing Director of Network Rail in Scotland because ScotRail and Network Rail have an alliance agreement with each other because we believe that track and train working together delivers better outcomes for passengers and taxpayers. And that's one of the many reasons why ScotRail outperforms its peers in terms of efficiency, customer satisfaction and reliability, because we've found a way of working in our fragmented GB railway system for Scotland.
So if it's on track, you'll go to the Minister, and if it's on passenger delivery of services, David goes to the Minister, is that right? Sorry, perhaps I'm being complicated. I'm trying to see what the pyramid is.
Essentially, Liam, Joe and I run the railway on a day-to-day basis. That's our job. Scottish Rail Holdings is responsible for the governance and oversight of ScotRail trains. And then the key strategic and policy decisions are made by the Scottish Government.
So who do you report to, Alex?
I have a dual reporting line, one to David as the chair of ScotRail, and the other to Andrew Haynes, who's the chief executive of Network Rail. And that's because we believe that track and train working together delivers better performance.
Okay. I'm just trying to understand the reporting. The more complicated reporting structures are, the more difficult it is, I think, to see a way through it. But if you think it works, I was under the impression the unions didn't think it worked or thought it was sufficiently opaque that they found it. They tried to just explain it, but they struggled, I think, in part.
I think what our trade union partners' commentary on the structure actually relates to the complexity of the rail structure across GB, which obviously is nothing to do with us. Our job is to just do the best job we can for passengers and taxpayers within the existing industry structure.
Right, OK. Ash, you're going to head off with the first questions, please.
Thank you. Good morning, panel.
I still didn't understand.
Transport Focus identifies value for money as passengers' number one priority, but they found that only 65% of ScotRail passengers considered their trip to be value for money. So I'm interested in your views and also what your organisation is able to do, either collectively or individually, to lower the cost of rail travel in Scotland. Who would like to attempt to answer that first?
Thank you. I'll start and then may bring others in. So clearly passengers primarily care about two things. One is the price of the ticket and the other is punctuality, and we work hard on both at all times. The Transport Focus independent survey also showed that customer satisfaction with ScotRail was at 90%, which is one of the highest of operators across Britain, but we know we can make it better. Clearly value for money scores were a little bit lower. Fares across ScotRail are on average around 20% lower than fares elsewhere in the UK, which is good news for passengers. And we've actually frozen ScotRail fares since January of last year, recognising the cost crisis which is being faced across the economy and society right now. And as I mentioned in my opening statement, in October we intend to undertake a trial where we abolish peak fares across the network for a period of 6 months. So improving the service, but also improving the value for money for passengers, is right at the heart of our strategy for delivering for the people of Scotland.
Okay. Who else would like to answer?
Anything? Comment if you like. I think the balance, one of the things that one has to remember is that there's a whole number of things of policy out there that we may touch upon today, but policy is a matter of government. And one of the aspects of that that's relevant to the question is the balance between fares from fare-paying passengers and subsidy from the government for operation. Mm-hmm. So we have to balance those priorities, and I think the balance at any particular one time is a matter for government. So if government wanted to spend more subsidy, it could reduce fares or vice versa.
Okay, Joanne.
Thank you. We are obviously committed to providing the best service possible to the travelling public in Scotland. And in terms of cost efficiency, as David said, you know, it's a matter for government on policy. But for example, we review our timetable twice a year. And just last year, we conducted our largest ever public consultation on our timetable as we re-emerge from the pandemic. So that's another example of the ways in which we're committed to providing the best value service for customers and being there when they need us.
Can you just explain for the committee the link then between timetable and fares?
Yeah, so in terms of my answer was specific to the public perception around value for money, and we consistently get feedback around where demand sits for our services and how that links to value for money.
Okay, thank you. Liam, do you have anything to add?
Sure. So within Network Rail, one of our five strategic priorities is to contribute towards a reduction of the net cost of the railway, because we recognise that operating, maintaining, renewing infrastructure is really expensive business. So at the moment, we're developing our strategic business plan for the next five-year period, which starts in April of next year. And as part of that, we're committing to several hundred million pounds worth of efficiencies that will help to drive down the overall net cost of the railway, so that we can make sure that there isn't a further burden on the Scottish taxpayer for that.
Okay, thank you. Clearly, the pandemic had quite a profound effect on the number of rail passengers who were travelling. I guess we're into a phase now where perhaps we're seeing that begin to sort of settle into what maybe we can call a new normal for numbers of rail passengers. Do you think that enough has been done to adjust services to meet these new travel patterns? And also, if you can give the committee an idea of what implications these changes in traveller numbers are having on rail finances, that would be helpful as well.
Yeah, sure. I'll take this initially. So what we've seen since the pandemic is extraordinary changes in the pattern of demand for rail services. So as we sit here today, our peak business is down by 40%, which is absolutely extraordinary. But our leisure market has recovered really strongly and is reaching pre-COVID levels. So broadly, we're taking about 80% of revenue on about 80% of pre-COVID service. And we're constantly looking at the service we provide to make sure it's adequate for the way that the market is bouncing back. So earlier this month, we changed our timetable. We added additional services where there was greater demand to operate. So, for example, we now run four trains an hour during the day between Edinburgh and Glasgow on a Saturday, and yet we don't Monday to Friday, something which would have been unthinkable 3.5 years ago. So whether you're in ScotRail or Network Rail, we're having to change our business to accommodate the new patterns of demand we're seeing. So, for example, Saturday is our busiest day on ScotRail now. Again, unthinkable 3.5 years ago. And between ScotRail and Network Rail, one of the things we've started to do is moving engineering work out of Saturdays so we can stay open as far as we can on the railway's busiest day. In terms of the impact of finances, obviously it's not been good. At the height of the pandemic, our revenue dropped by 92%. And for every pound we lost in farebox revenue, we had topped up through subsidy. And clearly the Scottish Government is keen to, for us to deliver a great service, but also reduce the subsidy requirement. Now, as it happens, as we sit here, we're very fortunate because actually revenue is coming back quite strongly. Obviously, last year there was quite a bit of industrial action around the network, which thankfully we're now clear of here in Scotland and forecast to remain so. That's a great environment in which we can market and promote the product, get people back on trains. So if I take Saturday just gone, we carried 300,000 people on the network. It was a very busy Saturday. That was 50% more than the year before. So growing revenue and being efficient is critical to reducing the subsidy requirement, as well as delivering a great service for passengers as well.
Thank you. David, Joanne, do you have anything to add?
I think, again, coming back to the fact that the world is continuing to adjust. We're not maybe convinced that people have found a definitive position as regards hybrid working. And the great thing about our timetable is we change it twice a year so we can continue to evolve and respond as passengers continue to find what the new norm actually is.
I think a really important point is, as colleagues have just said, to determine what the new norm is, and then provide services to satisfy that, because our role is ultimately to provide the best rail services that we can for the people of Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Liam, I didn't ask you to come in because I assume this is more directed at your colleagues, but if you have anything to add, feel free.
Thank you. I think Alex mentioned, you know, how we're looking at more innovative ways to take our what we call access to the railway to undertake engineering works. Mm-hmm. So we're spending time looking at whether moving works away from weekend. Traditionally, we usually do our work at weekends or at Easter holidays, Christmas holidays, things like that. But if that becomes more popular for customers, then we want to be agile and responsive to that. So we've got a really big programme working with operators and customers to understand when best to do our work so that we can more accurately reflect the changing travel demands. And we're really open to doing that because we really see that that's our part in this.
Okay, so just for my own personal curiosity, if we're saying Saturday is the new highest passenger number day or the busiest day, what's the new least busy day?
Sunday.
Right, okay. And is that a change or is that the same as it was before?
That is the same. But one of the things we did last year was negotiate a pay deal with ASLEF and RMT, who you heard from earlier on. And Joe's the expert on this, so I'll bring in Joe. But Sundays currently aren't in the working week for ScotRail staff. And as part of that pay deal, we agreed with ASLEF and RMT that we would work towards bringing Sundays within the working week by 2027. And if indeed that's successful, that will enable us to expand our Sunday service, because we actually think because the Sunday service is relatively limited, it's suppressing revenue in other days as well. Okay. And we want to be able to accommodate this leisure-driven growth to the railway. Mm-hmm. Joe, do you want to come in on the working party around Sundays?
Yeah. So for us and the trade unions, we have a lot more in common than it might sometimes appear on the surface. And one of the things that we are committed to is reducing our reliance on what we call rest day working. So we provide trains across 7 days of the week, but we actually contract our staff to work across 6 days of the week. So the working parties towards 2027 are focused on how we introduce Sundays so that we normalise them and that staff are in fact contracted across 4 or 5 days, and that Sunday is part of that contractual obligation, and that allows us greater flexibility when we're looking at future timetable reviews.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. The next questions come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning. We heard from the last panel about their reasons why they thought that there should be a challenge group created. I'd just like to hear what your thoughts are on that. Is that something that you'd be keen to see?
Obviously, we work with Transport Focus all the time on helping to listen what customers are saying about our service. So increasing the volume of the customer voice in the way we plan our service is absolutely critical. Transport Focus obviously undertake the independent survey, and we got a 90% satisfaction rating in that last survey, which we're very proud of, but we know it can be better. And Robert Sampson and all his colleagues are actually on our independently chaired stakeholder panel. So we're very keen to hear from Transport Focus if they've got some best practice or good practice from other sectors to see whether we can strengthen the customer voice within the way we run our services.
So, sorry, I'm being a bit thick this morning. Does that mean that you would be keen to see a challenge group going down into the depths that they were suggesting?
Anything which increases the voice of the customer in the way that we plan and deliver services, we'd absolutely support. Obviously, we saw the written submission from Transport Focus at the same time as you did, and that's something we'll be talking to Transport Focus about. We're always keen to learn from other sectors if there's an opportunity to strengthen the way we run the company.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, the next questions are actually going to come from me. So, my question is that one of the key milestones or assessments of the way the railway network was operating was to see whether the moving annual average performance targets were being met. And the Scottish Government constantly said that Abellio was failing them. And Alex, I remember you having to answer those questions. We now have less trains and we're still not meeting the target. So can somebody explain that to me, please?
So our target is 92.5% across the entire year. We measure trains those punctuality across the year because it's seasonal. And ever since the Network Rail RMT dispute was resolved, we've been delivering really strong operational performance. So we're delivering at that level currently. The challenge, of course, is to deliver it throughout the calendar year. What we've seen is a growing impact of severe weather on the network in the recent years. And we're working hard in Network Rail and ScotRail to reduce that impact. So primarily around extreme rainfall and, of course, the impact of autumn. So now that management in both organisations is undistracted by industrial action, we can work together on the improvement plans to improve punctuality. So as of this morning, we're at 89%. We're a few percentage points shy of the target, and that's for us to work together on to improve that. We believe it can be better, and we need to make it so.
But it was one of the reasons why Abellio lost the contract is that they failed to meet that target. And I remember having lots of discussions with you, Alex, about that in this meeting. We now have less trains, so there's less, should be less problems, but we're still not meeting the target. So was it wrong to criticise Abellio? Because it seems to be that you're blaming it on the weather, which Abellio were never given the opportunity of doing. I don't know. I'm struggling to understand.
As I mentioned earlier on, the rail industry is a system. And no matter what the structure or the ownership of the railway is, it's our job as railway managers to do the best possible job within the structure and ownership that we have. One of the things that is a benefit of public ownership is we can take a longer-term view. So, for example, if you're a short-term private operator, you're probably not going to invest in the resources in order to bring Sunday within the working week, for example, 5 years into the future. So that's an example where our ownership allows us to take a longer-term view because we don't have to worry about the short-term interests of shareholders. But from our perspective, particularly Liam, Joe and I, our job is to do the best job we can within the existing ownership structure.
Yeah, I still haven't had an answer to the question. Abellio were reaching roughly the same targets that you're reaching now. They were running more trains, so it was a more cluttered landscape, and they were criticised constantly for doing it by the Scottish Government, for failing to reach the target by the Scottish Government. But you're saying it's OK now because it's in public ownership, well, that target isn't met.
The ownership of ScotRail is a matter for Scottish Government, so you'd need to talk to them about why they took the decision that they did, which was to nationalise ScotRail at the breakpoint. I don't know whether you...
I understand the government will choose the ownership structure. I'm just saying that we were criticising somebody for not reaching the targets. You're not reaching the targets at the moment. Should you not be criticised as well?
We should be held to account, absolutely, which is one of the reasons why we're here. And I can guarantee you that colleagues in ScotRail and in Network Rail Scotland are working really hard on improving the punctuality of the service. I would add that even though we're not hitting target, ScotRail punctuality and customer sat outperforms most of its peers across GB, but we know it can be better and we will make it better.
So when do you imagine that you will reach the target that you aspire to?
That's current. We don't honestly know because, as I've highlighted, some of the things are not within our control. So what we're seeing is climate change happening for real. We now know that Scotland is being affected more by climate change than other parts of the UK. So not everything is within railway management's control. So our aim is to deliver that target as fast as we possibly can.
OK, it seems I'm hearing exactly the same story that I heard in 2019, just in a slightly different guise. Liam, the next question is yours.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. On a related point, David Lowry, how does Scottish Rail Holdings incentivise good performance by ScotRail? And equally, how does it penalise poor performance?
I think if we step back and look at what Scottish Rail Holdings is for, I think it's to help manage on behalf of the government good performance and improvement for the long term. A couple of the issues we've already touched on already are symptoms of long-term issues. We are, as I think some other colleagues said earlier, here to be expert railway people to help manage ScotRail trains on behalf of the government and public, the expert railway people to do it. So some of that is in terms of how we interface with them on a day-to-day basis and in board meetings, with the experience, you know, my part, for example, of 25 or so years in the industry and seeing things done elsewhere. It's about encouraging good behaviours for the long term.
Thanks for that, but I'm not sure I heard an answer as to how you incentivise performance or don't. Or is it just when you say you encourage better performance, is that just you're sitting in the board meetings and saying, come on, chaps, must do better?
I think it's about encouragement, mentoring, discouraging things that might have an adverse result, about taking the long view. One of the most important things we can do in that is make sure that we have the right people running the business day to day. Because if we're to look at, you know, and I say it's a long-term business, why is it a long-term business? Our assets last 30, 40, 50, 100 years. So the big decisions are made a long time out. And there's always an innate conflict between the long-term improvement, electrification, greening, etc., and the day-to-day issues of the timetable. You know, it rained yesterday, whatever. So, but these things are, how do we address them in the long-term and set the long-term direction and tone?
Thank you. Just before I hand back, a very quick question to Alex Hines then. I think what I'm hearing is that there's no financial incentive either to promote good performance or to penalise poor performance coming from Scottish Rail Holdings. Just for the avoidance of doubt, is there any similar incentive scheme coming from any other body?
So there is a performance regime which governs the performance of the trains across GB Rail. So if ScotRail causes a delay, it pays compensation to Network Rail. If Network Rail causes a delay, it pays compensation to ScotRail. So that incentivises both parties to improve punctuality. Scottish Rail Holdings holds ScotRail to account, and the Office of Rail and Road holds Network Rail to account. And one of the good things about working in Scotland is Transport Scotland set an identical performance target for both ScotRail and for Network Rail, and the two teams work together to improve punctuality.
And how does Transport Scotland penalise if those targets aren't met?
So ORR would take enforcement action against Network Rail if it felt that Network Rail wasn't taking all reasonable steps to improve performance. And ScotRail management is held to account by Scottish Rail Holdings. And where targets are not met, we have to produce a performance improvement plan.
Understand. Kabina.
Just before we briefly move on, if I may, under Abellio's, when they were in charge, there used to be the Squire Fund, which used to get lots of money from Abellio in fines and then was used to increase and upgrade infrastructure across the network. Does the Squire Fund still exist? Do you have to contribute to it? And if it doesn't exist, have the monies that have been lost from that fund been made up by the Scottish Government?
So Squire, as in the incentive regime, doesn't exist any longer. So that was a function of the franchise agreement between Transport Scotland and Abellio ScotRail. What we have now in the grant agreement, which has replaced the franchise agreement, is a regime called service quality, which looks very, very similar, but it doesn't have the financial penalties and bonuses attached to it. And I'm pleased to say that actually our performance on that service quality regime is really rather good right now, but it's no longer a financial regime.
OK. I seem to remember it did rather a lot of good, the Squire Fund, to many stations. Mark, I think you've got the next questions.
Yeah, I just want to go back to industrial relations again. I mean, the first panel we had this morning, union colleagues, we were getting a strong impression that things had perhaps turned the corner, things were improving. Can you say a bit more about what your impressions are of industrial relations and whether you think anything needs to continue to improve or change in that regard?
Yeah, of course. So, I mean, the committee heard from this morning three of the four rail trade unions, and you will have heard from them that their overall impression of the first year of public ownership of ScotRail was a positive one. In fact, I think one of our colleagues said that industrial relations had dramatically improved, for which particularly Joe, the COO of ScotRail, deserves a big amount of credit for that. Clearly, as Joe mentioned, on most things we actually agree. We want to deliver a great service for passengers, we want to see a growing railway, and we want to provide great jobs for our staff. So we would agree that industrial relations have improved under the first year of public ownership. And one of the things that Joe and the team have been working hard on recently is actually this year's pay round. And as we sit here today, our staff, as LEF and RMT members in ScotRail, are voting under a referendum for a pay deal, which the trade union has recommended to our staff that they accept. So, Joe, anything you'd like to add on that?
Yeah, thanks, Alex. And thank you for your words, but none of this works without all of the parties coming to the table. So there's a huge deal of credit to be given to the trade unions and to many of my management colleagues who, they all work consistently hard. You don't do a pay deal, as many of you will know, by sitting down once a year and having a conversation. This is about day-to-day relationships and hard work from all sides. Transparency under public sector is certainly helping us in terms of our industrial relations climate. We've just opened an employee engagement survey to get a real temperature test as to where our culture is at as a public sector employer. And we will remain committed to working with our trade unions. Will we always agree on everything? No, but that's not the deal. The deal is that they should challenge us and we should challenge them. And as long as relationships remain constructive, we remain optimistic that we can work in partnership and actually really deliver the best railway in Scotland. Because whether it be our customers or whether it be our staff, our railway is about people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's what's important to us.
OK. That's very good to hear. Can I just switch back, actually, to the question about the removal of peak time fares and that pilot from October? I mean, it sounds like one outcome to this might be that a lot of people start getting back on the trains again, which is great for farebox income. But I suppose, you know, there may be issues there around overcrowding potentially. I don't know. How prepared are you to introduce that pilot? Because I guess it's a little bit of an unknown now,
yeah,
given that we're in a new normal and the peak has moved, yeah, anyway.
So obviously it's a trial. And one of the reasons why it's a trial is we're not entirely sure how customers will react to that trial, which is the abolition of peak fares for 6 months across all routes from October. And one of the things we've seen is these huge shifts in the market. And obviously, as you might imagine, we've got our experts trying to predict what is going to be the impact of, you know, one of the boldest fares initiatives that we've seen anywhere across rail, full stop, let alone in this country. And there's probably quite a wide range of outcomes. We even the best modellers in the world won't be able to predict this with a level of accuracy. So we've got to be flexible to be able to respond to that. Where we need to add additional carriages or additional services, we will, where resources are available. But, for example, currently some of our busiest trains are actually the first off-peak train because people are holding back to buy the cheaper fare. And so what we'll probably need to do is reallocate the way we use our carriages across the network to accommodate that. But we do have spare seats available still in the peak across most of the network. And where we think that we need to add more carriages and more services, we will.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks.
OK, Monica, did you want to come in on that?
Yeah, thank you, convener. Both panels this morning have sort of talked us through the new institutional arrangements and how they're working, how they might be improved. It is only a year on. But I was keen to pick up an issue that's been raised in Parliament recently. according to board papers that have become public, the former chair of ScotRail, Chris Gibb, who was also the chief executive officer of Scottish Rail Holdings, I hope I've got that correct, he's no longer in those roles, but he raised concerns about micromanagement by Scottish ministers, advisers and officials. David Lowry, do you recognise that characterisation?
I obviously can't talk for Chris personally. In terms of his leaving, he had a fixed-term contract and he was employed by Scottish Rail Holdings for the entire originally expected period of that contract. So it was always anticipated in that sense contractually that he would leave when he did. In terms of those phrases, I've heard those phrases since he left. Before I knew he was going, I had no conversations with him on that sort of stuff in terms of worries. And I just do not recall a conversation before he announced he was not going.
So just so I've got this right, so back in 2022, you were the chief financial officer?
That's correct.
Is that correct? So we've heard a little bit about how the different organisations work and the different interfaces. So did you have contact with government, both ministers and officials?
I've always had routine contact with government, various civil servants, officials, etc. And I've met the ministers on several occasions, but the main contact is always with the officials.
Okay. So you've not had concern about micromanagement?
Since I became chief executive officer and chairman of ScotRail, I've got no concerns on that. I think the relationships have all worked very well.
So that's
we've got
now,
a good relationship with government.
But in the past, was there interference by ministers, for example, from Jenny Gilruth? Was there overreach?
I think government funds us substantially, and it's quite entitled to make requests from time to time to, because it sets policies, it wants to implement this or implement that, whatever. We have plenty of requests, plenty of discussions with government officials. That's the extent of it, really, I think.
Yeah, I think we'd expect that to be robust, but you're not aware of any... I mean, there's been some discussion in Parliament that might have been interference by ministers or overreach, so you don't have those concerns, you didn't experience that or witness that.
I think the actions of ministers are probably a question for government rather than ourselves as the actual operators and managers of the business.
Okay, but always keen to hear from our panel, so thank you for that, convener. I'll leave it there.
I was interested to see where that was going. Liam, you're next.
Thank you, convener. Joanne Maguire, how will ScotRail go about procuring new rail stock? Will that be through Roscoe's or is ScotRail going to do it directly?
So, thank you for your question. It's very early days with regards to our procurement journey, and I will bring David in because we will do our procurement with and through Scottish Rail Holdings, as you would expect, because they set governance and they set policy. What I would like to reassure the panel is that we are hugely aware that these are some of the largest investments that the Scottish Government will have made and will make for some time. When we go to procure our rolling stock, we are making significant long-term commitments on behalf of the government when we procure, and we are hugely aware of our responsibilities as a public sector body. But as regards to technicalities, it is very early days, but I don't know if, David, you want to comment.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as Joe said, very early days. These are assets that we are hoping and expecting to acquire sometime over the next 10 years, which will last generations to come. Therefore, I think it's absolutely the right thing to do to consider with our colleagues in government how we fund those at that time and what the best way to do it is. And I would not want to close any options down at this stage, because we need to appraise that decision of, you know, whether it came from a Roscoe or internal funding or somewhere else at the time that we make that decision.
Thank you. I'll stick with you, David Lowry, if I may, then, because Transport Scotland has expressed that Scotland's railway should be decarbonised by 2035. So given the hopes and expectations that you've just outlined, how can you ensure that there will be effective decarbonisation by 2035?
I think it's all about steps in the road. It's how do we plan the long term? What can we do each day and year to make things better? In terms of when decarbonisation will happen, we will only be able to know that once it's happened. I think we have a series of decisions. To wholly decarbonise the railway, you'd have to electrify every route in terms of current terms. And that's really a question for colleagues at Network Rail as to when they could do that, because then once it was electrified, we'd have zero carbon trains on it. Yeah.
So in 2020, Transport Scotland published its Rail Services Decarbonisation Action Plan, which committed to removing diesel vehicles from the network by 2035. Now, of course, most passenger journeys on ScotRail are already made on electric trains. So we've already decarbonised most of the network already, and we've got a proud record of electrification here in Scotland. We're currently on site electrifying the railway between Glasgow and Barrhead. We're electrifying the railway between Glasgow and East Kilbride. So we'll have electric trains running around to Barrhead later this year, in fact. And between ScotRail, Network Rail, Transport Scotland and Scottish Rail Holdings, we're working on the plan to decarbonise, which will see more electrification and decarbonised trains. And we've got a joined up track and train plan for that. The decarbonisation action plan, which was published in 2020, that's due a refresh this year. And we're working with Transport Scotland officials on that.
And I think it's important to say the biggest thing we can do in that is encourage mode switch from, for example, roads to rails. And we can only do that by providing reliable services that people believe in. That's what union colleagues were talking about earlier on, and it's why we're all in one community in this. We have shared objectives, which is why we want to all improve performance.
Sticking with Alex Hines and sticking with exactly that point, union colleagues were pretty clear earlier on that whilst most journeys might be electrified, there is a significant part of the network which is not and is running on 50-year-old high-speed trains. And we heard earlier, this committee heard earlier, just how polluting they are in relation to an example given in Glasgow. But Kevin Lindsay also raised significant concerns about safety on these HSTs. The RAIB, after Carmont, raised or made significant points certainly about these HSTs. And you heard, I'm sure, Mr. Hines, Kevin Lindsay's points about how crucial it was that these were replaced. So, Alex Hines, what is being done to replace the high-speed trains, and when will they be replaced?
So, we're already planning the renewal of the high-speed trains, essentially the intercity fleet for ScotRail. As it stands today, those trains are on lease by ScotRail until 2030, but we are looking at options to replace them earlier than that in the context of the need to decarbonise. So currently you've got a high-speed train which runs from Glasgow to Aberdeen and it's diesel operated all the way, even though we have wires to Stirling. So, for example, one of the things we're looking at is could we procure a hybrid train, for example, which would enable us to run electric at least out of the city centres and then move on to diesel power later in the context of the overall deadline of decarbonisation by 2035. Obviously, we're aware of ASLEF's concerns around the safety of the high-speed trains. Those trains are safe. They have a good safety record. They meet all the requirements to operate safely on the GB rail network. But we, recognise ASLEF's concerns, and we're working with them constructively on those concerns. So in the coming weeks, we're actually going to modify those trains in line with the Rail Accident Investigation Branch report, which was published in the March of last year. Since the tragic accident at Stonehaven on the 12th of August 2020, we took immediate steps to reduce the chances of that happening again, and whether that's on the infrastructure, on the rolling stock, or indeed our control centre and our operational rules, we've already made the network a lot safer. But we need to make sure we track all of those 20 rail accident investigation branch recommendations through to conclusion. In fact, we've got a meeting with the trade unions on that next week.
So just to be absolutely clear and reflect that back, notwithstanding the RAIB, ASLEF's concerns, driver dissatisfaction, it could be 2030 before Scotland's Railway fully moves on from those HSTs?
Currently, they're on lease until 2030. And clearly, if we decided to replace them earlier than that, then that ultimately is a decision for government.
Convener.
So I understand that. That would require the development of a new train. And I remember certainly when the 125s or the HSTs came up 6 years ago, you were saying they were a great step forward. But the railway, the new Hitachi trains took quite a long time to come into service and development. We're 2023 now, we're 7 years away. If the design process started now and the procurement process started now, would they be available by 2030?
Yes. Basically, from a standing start through to the delivery of a fleet of new trains in passenger service, that process takes about 5 years from start to end. We've already done some advanced work on procurement of a suburban fleet, for example, enabling us to retire some of our diesel trains in the next 5 years. If you look at our rolling stock strategy, we've got a clear plan where we essentially procure new trains as rolling stock reaches its date of life expiry. And we've got a rolling stock plan which is complementary with the infrastructure plan so we can deliver the decarbonisation. We don't just want more modern trains so we can deliver great services for passengers. We also want decarbonised services as well. So, for example, on the Aberdeen to Central Belt project, we are already bringing bridges down on that route in advance of full electrification. And that development work is being funded by the Scottish Government, even though we're not in full delivery mode yet.
Final question before I go to Jackie. Just on, you say the contract for the leasing lasts till 2030. Are there break clauses before that, or are you absolutely tied in without significant penalty or with significant penalties if you break that lease early?
I don't have that contractual detail, and even if I did, it would probably be commercially confidential because those trains are, of course, owned by Angel Trains Limited. But as it stands, they're on lease to ScotRail to 2030.
I think if we could just amplify one of the key things Alex said there was options. We're continually looking at options, de-risking things, how to do things and to reduce emissions in the long term, do things in the short term, modal switch, as low as reasonably practical, which we are bound to do for safety, these trains are safe, and for the financial duties to taxpayers to provide value for money. So we're continually looking at options and to work out the best and most robust way through this for the long term.
Okay, thank you. Jackie, the next questions are with you.
Thank you. Can I ask you what your plans are on how you're going to improve the accessibility of Scotland's rail network, especially around about improving access at stations and making sure that the new rolling stock allows level boarding from platforms?
Thank you. Well, obviously, the services we provide, we want to be for everybody. Mm-hmm. And we have a Victorian rail network where that wasn't a priority, but we're investing heavily both in ScotRail and indeed Network Rail to improve the accessibility of our network. One of the things we're very proud of, is we roster two people on board every train so we can help people board and alight trains. But obviously people with reduced mobility want the ability to turn up and go, quite rightly. So any new trains which we procure in the future will have level boarding as a requirement built into that procurement process. And what that means is where the platform is a standard height, it will deliver perfect level boarding between track and train. Now, obviously, that's a relative, you know, medium to long-term investment. But as we stand here today, across the network, we're investing in Access for All schemes, where we fit accessible footbridges to improve accessibility. So we recently completed schemes at Johnston, at Croy. I was at Port Glasgow a couple of weeks ago on site looking at the project to deliver an Access for All scheme there to improve the overall accessibility of our railway. So it's a big part of our plans, both on trains and on infrastructure, and indeed the way we operate the service.
In regards to your platforms, is there going to be a lot of work needed for all the platforms, or do you think that it's just going to be the occasional one? I didn't mean.
So the more modern rolling stock generally has a lower floor anyway, okay. So it will reduce the size of the gap. So that's great news everywhere. For example, on the Borders Railway, which is a relatively new railway, which opened in 2015, all the platforms are of what we call a standard height, compliant with the standard. And that will deliver perfect level boarding everywhere. Where we go in and undertake infrastructure work, so maybe we might be renewing a platform or creating a new platform, all the new infrastructure investment is built to that standard, so it would deliver the perfect level boarding if the train had level boarding.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Jackie, the next questions come from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. I want to return to the issue of antisocial behaviour. We heard from the panel this morning some of the challenges and some of the real concerns. I think it was Mick Hogg at RMT was suggesting that perhaps it's getting out of control already, and he doesn't want to be the person to say, "I told you so." And he talked about, you know, we could have something really serious happen, including the loss of life in future. I don't know, Joanne Maguire, I think you've got responsibility for safety, so perhaps you could kick this off. But what are the challenges around antisocial behaviour? What's causing it, and what is the impact right now, both for passengers and for staff?
Yeah. Thank you, and you'll not be surprised here. We talk to the trade unions about this a lot, and we are committed to resolving it. Our starting point, and what I've discussed with the trade unions, unfortunately, antisocial behaviour isn't a ScotRail issue, and it's not a railway issue. This is a much broader societal issue, and I'm sure the panel are much better versed on that than I am. We were encouraged to see that the Scottish Government are going to launch conversations in schools, talking about violence in schools and what can be done to tackle that. And we are committed to working with partners across the public sector as to how we best tackle antisocial behaviour, because unfortunately we are seeing a lot coming from the younger elements of our population. Whether it be a member of staff or a passenger, our strong view is that one assault is one assault too many. And we want to do our best to protect all parties. We're working with British Transport Police, where we look at hotspots and where we're seeing specifically challenging areas. We've increased the numbers on our travel safe team, who are a team who work out and about around our network and work with our on-train staff and sometimes in stations to best prevent antisocial behaviour. But unfortunately, there are no magical answers or no simple answers. We were delighted that the Scottish Government recently backed our spending on body cameras. They're fast becoming a very important element in terms of our preventative measures. And we will see an increase, a threefold increase in the availability of body cameras for our staff from around September of this year. So there are lots of different ways in which we're tackling antisocial behaviour. And as I say, very, very cognisant of the fact there is a societal issue out there.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point that you made, and we did discuss in the earlier session about the forthcoming summit looking at violence in schools. But I think a joined up approach would be a smart one. That's been helpful. What more could we do in the Parliament and indeed across government? I'm looking back at what Jenny Glover said last year about discussions between ministers, particularly transport and justice, looking at whether more legislation is required. Clearly there's a frustration that there are offenders and persistent offenders who cause havoc and then get back on the train hours later or days later. So could legislation play a useful part in terms of trying to better manage access to Scotland's railways for those who are persistent, you know, offenders in terms of violent and serious disorder?
Yeah, colleagues might want to further comment, but what we're focused on in ScotRail is what we can directly influence for our staff and our passengers at ScotRail. One of our challenges is we run what is broadly an open network. So it is impossible for BTP, for Police Scotland and others to be everywhere at any given time. So we are committed to ensuring that we have the right staff in the right place to try and ensure that we drive down, for example, ticketless travel, which is another reason for which we see antisocial behaviour. In terms of policy legislation, obviously that's a matter for government. But now that we are within the public sector, we are looking at multi-agency work where we can to best combat. So, for example, we've been engaging with local authorities where we see specific incidences of antisocial behaviour and how we can best partner with them on it.
OK. And just to ask about the particular issues that have affected women and girls, Jenny Glowruth in posts put quite a lot of focus on that. What has been done to improve the safety and security of women and girls travelling on the Scottish Rail Network?
So I think the starting point is we acknowledge the study that was done by Scottish Government across public transport and specifically looking at women and girls who use public transport. We don't want anyone, whether women, girls or any of our users, to feel unsafe. So ways in which we're working. So we're working with British Transport Police. As I mentioned, we've increased the numbers of our travel safe team. And we are looking at how we best man our stations and our trains at times when safety may be a particular concern or where we have particular safety hotspots. I think, as I mentioned, it's something we're really committed to and we are working in partnership with our trade unions, but unfortunately, like the broader societal piece, there's just no magic answers.
So can the public be confident that there's a zero tolerance policy against antisocial behaviour or criminality on Scotland's railways?
Yes, so we have made very public statements. People may have seen them through social media, through our various ways of communicating, that we do take a zero tolerance approach, whether it be violence against members of the public or in fact against our own staff.
Thank you.
I thought it was interesting the attitude that I didn't realise that the chains were pulled, you know, to stop the train on numerous occasions and there hadn't been one single conviction. It seems to be that there needs to be a complete mind switch on what's acceptable and not acceptable on trains. We heard about spitting and feet on seats. Are you going to do anything to address that? Because it's not just can't be other people, it's got to be you pushing it, because that all would be contrary to the culture of respect for the staff who have to operate the railways.
So, as Joe says, one of the things we've done in the last... since COVID, we're replacing our body cam fleet. And it's voluntary for our staff to use body cams, it's up to them. And what we're seeing is growing use of our body cams. We rolled them out 6 years ago now. They've been phenomenally successful. And we're seeing increasing use and we're in the process of replacing those. And one of the reasons why we're such strong advocates of body cams, if our staff want to use them, is that we
can collect evidence which can be used in prosecutions, which obviously is a real challenge. We didn't used to have a travel safe team, and now we have a travel safe team of 28 colleagues who help support passengers and staff on those bits of the network where we get hotspots. So it might be particular lines of route, certain times of day, it might be event-driven, good weather, people go down to the coast and they come back having consumed alcohol. Those are the sorts of activities that that team undertake to try and keep the network safe for everybody.
I think some of those cameras came from the Square Fund, if I remember rightly, which would be a welcome addition to the safety on the train. But are you encouraging staff to lead prosecutions or push for a prosecution where people behave badly? Because I think that's important.
We're encouraging our staff to take a body cam if that's what they would like to do whilst they're undertaking their work, because we know on the rare occasions when something does go wrong, that evidence is absolutely critical if we're able to mount a prosecution, or indeed the police are. Of course, the British Transport Police are responsible for the policing of the network, which is why we work in partnership with them to keep the network safe.
Thank you. Mark, you've got a question.
Thanks. Can I ask about your plans for ticket offices? Or maybe we should just call them station offices, because it's quite clear that the staff working there do a lot more than just ticket sales. Where are those plans currently sitting? Because, you know, there was some widespread concern, not just from rail unions, but from passenger groups about either ticket office closures or changing the times that these offices are open and how that might impact on the passenger safety and the passenger experience. And I think, you know, the first panel this morning, you know, we were hearing again about antisocial behaviour and how having staff stations may actually help with that as well. So can you give us a rundown on where we're actually at with your plans, which were quite widely opposed.
I'll bring Joe in shortly, but the first thing to say is we're not planning to close any ticket offices, and actually no decisions have been made. So that's the first thing. A couple of years ago now, we did a big review of the way we staffed our stations, and we made some proposals which we consulted on, and we made some changes to those proposals in the light of the consultation. So it was a genuine listening exercise, and we changed our proposals in the light of the consultation responses that we got. We believe there's an opportunity to improve the visibility of staff for customers, to be more efficient and to grow revenue, reflecting the fact that the way people buy tickets has fundamentally changed over the last 30 years when we've not changed our ticket office opening hours. So as we sit here today, 62% of our revenue comes from self-service methods and 16% comes from ticket offices. So this is about adjusting what our staff do and where they do it as customers change their behaviour. But as I said at the outset, no closures are proposed and no decisions have been made. This is a matter for government. Joe, anything you'd like to add?
Yeah. So the starting point would be that as part of last year's pay deal, we agreed there would be 6 years protection on no compulsory redundancies at ScotRail. And when we approach our station staffing strategy, we will engage comprehensively with our trade unions. When we looked to review opening hours, we didn't actually just look at it through the lens of ticket sales. We took a more holistic view. So, for example, we carried out a diversity impact assessment, and through that we took our original proposals and we added 167 hours back in, where we identified there was demand for assistance boarding or disembarking our trains. So it's not just through a single lens of ticket sales. As I say, when we have authority to progress, we will engage extensively with our trade unions, and their input to this will be really important. But this is about making our railway as safe as possible. This is about trying to decrease ticketless travel, which reduces our reliance on subsidy, but it is also part of our deterrent measures against antisocial behaviour. And this is about staff being more visible which again is a further deterrent to antisocial behaviour and an enhancement to our desire to be in the most accessible railway that we can.
Yeah. I mean, that original consultation and your reflection on it has you know, some time has elapsed between that and now. And, you know, we talked earlier on about the new normal, removal of peak time fares, you know, travel changing, perhaps consistently changing. Is the kind of the plan that you've currently got, is that still fit for purpose? Might it change again? Is there clarity on what the demand on staff might be at stations?
Well, I think what I would say is that the longer time elapses from the point at which we consulted on the proposal, then obviously some of the assumptions we made become out of date because we're seeing this huge changes in demand patterns. Just to reiterate, we're not proposing to close any ticket offices and no decisions have been made. And if and when government would like us to proceed with those changes, we'll engage fully with the trade unions on any of those changes, which would include any changes to the way customers have changed their behaviour since we originally did the review.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just trying to get a sense of whether, you know, this decision, a government decision, is now sort of overdue, in which case is it worth just revisiting the whole thing again? Because if things have shifted, is it not better for government to sort of reconsider where we are now and then maybe come to a decision? Or are you still wanting a decision sooner than later on this, based on your current proposals?
Well, what I would say is, obviously, our job is to run the railway as it is today, and key strategic and policy decisions like station staffing, like fares, like the peak fares trial are a matter for government. And so those conversations are happening all the time between ScotRail Trains, its owner, Scottish Rail Holdings, and officials about the finances and the service that we provide to customers.
Okay.
Thank you, Mark. Now we come to the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
Thank you. And yes, I think we're still good morning. Just can I check that it's correct to say that you do think that it is realistic for Scotland's railways to be decarbonised by 2035? Is that correct?
That's correct. Yes.
Yep. In doing so, would you also be looking at other new alternative technologies, whether it's hydrogen, battery electric? Is that something that you are looking at, or do you think that's sufficiently not advanced to be part of your planning?
So, yes, we are looking at alternative technologies. So, primarily, our assumption is that in order to decarbonise, we would electrify the network and procure electric trains, because we don't just want to electrify ScotRail services, we also want to electrify freight, for example. And we're seeing very strong demand for rail freight in Scotland. But there are some parts of our network which we would never electrify because it's just not economic to do so. So looking at other opportunities like hydrogen trains and battery trains is under active consideration. And colleagues from ScotRail and Network Rail are talking to the suppliers of this rolling stock and indeed visiting countries which already operate this rolling stock to see what lessons we can learn so we can decide what's appropriate for Scotland. So, you know, pre-pandemic, I went out to Germany to see one of the manufacturers' hydrogen trains in passenger service already. And there are some pros and cons of each different type of whether you go electric, whether you go hybrid, whether you go hydrogen. One of the key obstacles we've got right now on hydrogen is actually the cost of it. What we want to do is make sure that as we decarbonise the network, we don't add cost in, because that will just increase the subsidy which is required from the taxpayer. So we want to decarbonise, but we also want to deliver a great service for passengers and be efficient at the same time. So on trunk routes like Central Belt to Aberdeen or Inverness, we're anticipating full electrification. But in other parts of the network, like the Far North Line or the West Highland Line, actually the solution to decarbonisation will probably be around the train rather than the overhead wires.
And in those discussions, I think, with the Scottish Government and indeed energy suppliers, would you think in terms of the sourcing of some of this renewable energy being in the northeast and the places you've just described, that there might be a more integrated approach to how we might view railway energy and delivery of trains services in the future?
Yes. So obviously, as part of our decarbonisation plan, we're talking to the providers of electricity because we're going to need a lot more of it.
Yeah.
And so making sure they've got the investment to prepare their network for it. So, for example, right now we're investing £120 million on the infrastructure to work with the power suppliers to upgrade the power supply in advance of electrification. And then we're also talking to the hydrogen sector in places like Aberdeen, but not only Aberdeen. My understanding of hydrogen economics is that it works better where a number of different industries decide to club together in one space to drive down the cost to make it economic. As we sit here today, we believe the costs of operating a hydrogen train could be up to double what it is to operate a diesel train, which clearly would not be good news for taxpayers. So there's some work for us to do with the hydrogen sector to drive down the cost so it actually makes sense for us.
And then looking at infrastructure issues, we've heard from unions about real concerns about safety in terms of investment in maintenance and obviously repair of existing lines. So do you have sufficient investment in terms of capital to deliver that?
So the short answer to that question is yes, and I'll bring Liam in shortly, but the way the infrastructure is funded is that every 5 years the Scottish Government sets out the outputs it wants the infrastructure to deliver, the funding that's available, and in fact in recent weeks the Scottish Government has just made an over £4 billion commitment to the operations, maintenance and renewal of the infrastructure in Scotland, which is a great vote of confidence, in fact, in what the rail industry does here. In Network Rail, we have a productivity scheme called Modernising Maintenance, and that's about making the way we undertake maintenance on the infrastructure more efficient. We've actually recently concluded consultation with trade union colleagues here in Scotland on that, and we're working through the safety validation of it. Those proposals are safe. If they weren't safe, we wouldn't do them. But the way maintenance is currently undertaken to the infrastructure is relatively old-fashioned, and we're seeking to modernise it. Liam, anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, thanks, Alex. So what I'd say at the outset is safety is our number one priority when it comes to maintaining the railway, and we would never even propose anything that we didn't think was completely safe. And that's not just our internal view of safety. We'll go through hazard workshops with the Office of Road and Rail, who are our safety regulator, and they will make sure that we're not proposing anything unsafe. So as Alex says, modernising maintenance is about changing the way in which we do it. It's about making it more productive. So if I give you a very quick example, if we do signalling maintenance and maintenance to the signals, to the points and things like that, over 95% of the tasks we do to maintain the signalling infrastructure can be done with two people. But at the moment, our rules say we send three people to every single thing. And all we want to do in the future is send the right number of people, which will be two for 95% of the time, and then more for the remaining 5% of activity. So we're making those sorts of changes which will improve productivity, but safety is the number one priority, and that will not change, and we are funded perfectly adequately to continue to maintain the railway safely.
And then finally, are there any of your current major infrastructure projects that aren't on time and on budget? And David Lowry talked about the need for modal shift, and clearly if we want to try and stop increasing number of commuters going into Edinburgh, the proposed developer-led Winchburgh station would be a good relief for that, and I'm expecting to hear from the Network Rail and the others in terms of the report that's being prepared at the request of the former Transport Minister to help get revised costings on that. So two parts to that question. One national and one local, but it has...
It has
implications for Edinburgh and the modal shift that David Lowry referred to.
So, first of all, on the project side, we've got a proud record, actually, in Scotland of delivering these infrastructure projects not only on time and on budget, e.g. the Levermouth project, which we're creating a brand new railway, which will open next year, which will be incredible for that part of Scotland, or new stations. But actually, we're trying to drive down the unit cost of delivering those so we can deliver more lines of route, more new stations for the same amount of money. And we've got a good track record of that. It's far cheaper to build a new station in Scotland than it is elsewhere in the UK, for example. And later this year, we'll be opening some more stations. On Winchborough specifically, again, pre-pandemic, I was able to undertake a site visit with you and others at the time. The intention is the developer would contribute to that. And in the last few weeks, I've personally reviewed a submission between Network Rail and officials. And that very, very recently was sent to colleagues at Transport Scotland, who will no doubt be considering it. So if we're able to secure an appropriate contribution for the developer of that scheme, there's no reason why we couldn't build a new station at Winchborough.
And I'm assuming from what you're saying that all the other major infrastructure projects are on time or budget, and indeed you're getting more value for money than perhaps previously.
Indeed.
Thank you.
Liam.
Very quickly, that I was interested in that line of questioning. Alex Hines, going back to the projects being delivered, you will have seen me ask earlier about the commitment in 2016 by the Scottish Government to invest £200 million to achieve a 20-minute reduction between Aberdeen and the Central Belt. And you heard me say earlier that only, to the best of my knowledge, just over 1% of that has actually been spent. And that project, we haven't got the deliverables of the 20-minute reduction. So it doesn't sound like that project is on time. Can you give this committee any update on whether that £200 million will be spent and when the 20-minute reduction will be delivered?
So that £200 million that you reference was actually a city deal around Aberdeen. It wasn't money which was given from Transport Scotland to the rail industry. So we wouldn't recognise that as a project which was currently in flight. But we've got a strategy for the Aberdeen to Central Belt line, which essentially sees us speeding up journey times between now and 2026. And we're delivering infrastructure already to help deliver that. Particularly in the Perth area. We're also going to expand the gauge, which is the size of the route, to enable us to accommodate more freight trains in advance of electrification, which we would like to do in the early 2030s. So one of the issues we've wrestled with is often, even though it's Aberdeen City deal money, from a railway perspective, it makes more sense to spend it outside of the region than within the region. But we've got a clear strategy for that route. And any of those big investment decisions, obviously, are a matter for Transport Scotland. We're doing all the design and development work for that Aberdeen to Central Belt strategy. You may have heard me communicate that with stakeholders at a recent stakeholder roundtable. And we're already in delivery in terms of advance works on that route, where we're already demolishing bridges which need to come down in order to electrify.
Thank you.
Okay, there seems to be a whole heap of what I'm assured brief supplementary questions. I haven't found one of those brief supplementary ones, but let's see, Mark, if you can buck the trend.
I'll make it brief. I mean, it's just to pick up on the point about cost reduction, particularly in relation to new stations. I mean, it seems that there might be an opportunity to bring more new stations onto the existing rail network if there was a shift to more modular stations. And, you know, sites that have been mentioned to me have been, you know, Torlundi, Evanton, Newborough, where lower cost stations could be brought in without necessarily having to build new rail lines. What's your thoughts on that? Is there still innovation to go in terms of the rail industry and expanding the network?
Sounds like a short question,
Alex.
Modular stations are a great idea in theory, but actually the rail network isn't uniform. So take Winchburgh, for example, where actually there's quite a steep cutting. A modular station wouldn't work in that area. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we've done in ScotRail and in Network Rail is actually learn by doing and set ourselves the objective of getting better each time. And that generally is what we've done. So for a sort of standard two-platform station here in Scotland, we can do that for about £15 million. In other parts of the country, you know, numbers of 25 are quoted.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Monica.
Thank you. I've heard some concerns that ScotRail has an ageing workforce, with the average age around sort of 48. I just wonder what has been done to address that and how many apprenticeships will be filled this year and next.
So I'll invite Joe to come in on specifically apprenticeships, because I know that's an issue with RMT in ScotRail. So we do generally have an ageing workforce, which is one reason why both ScotRail and Network Rail are doing huge amounts of recruitment, in fact, as we replace those people who are due to leave the workforce. Actually, in recent months, we have seen a slowdown in people leaving us. Obviously, there's no retirement age anymore. And obviously, we've seen cost pressures elsewhere in the economy, so people have retained in employment a little bit longer. Both Network Rail and ScotRail have well-established apprenticeship programmes, not just in traditional roles like engineering, but in other places as well, customer service, IT, for example. And certainly the apprentice strategy in ScotRail is something we recently discussed with the RMT. Joe, would you like to come in on that specifically?
Yeah, thank you. As Alex said, it's becoming increasingly difficult to predict retirement ages due to the fact that there simply is no default retirement age. And like some of the murmurs I heard from the committee, that the cut-off age of 48 being indicative of an ageing workforce is a bit of a concern to myself and others. We are seeing staff working beyond 65 and beyond 70, some, unfortunately, as Alex referred to, due to the simple inflationary pressures, and staff who told us they may retire this year simply changing their decision-making. We're working really hard, not just on apprentices, but across the piece in terms of recruitment. Scotland, as many of you will know, is in the fortunate position of having even lower unemployment rates than the rest of the UK just now, and unemployment is really low just now, being under 4%. We want to do more on apprenticeships, but not just traditional apprenticeships. So I've been talking to trade unions about how we attract more young people and increase our apprenticeship numbers, but indeed what we can do to offer, and excuse my parlance, but this is my old-fashioned language, adult apprenticeships. So how can we offer opportunities to our existing workforce who want to upskill, whether they be in our operational businesses, whether they be in our support functions, or in traditional areas that you'd associate apprenticeships with, like engineering. And we're hearing some great ideas coming from our workforce about how we can upskill and offer apprenticeships, not just to people joining us, but internally as well. So there's lots to be done on it, and lots of ideas and innovation coming through. And we are proactively engaging with Skills Development Scotland and other partners.
That's great. And if you can't give the numbers today, could you write to us and keep us informed?
Of course.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just looking around the table to see if there anyone else wanted to come in. Thank you. Very wide-ranging discussion today. We've heard quite a bit about Edinburgh and Glasgow and Winchburgh and Aberdeen, and the panel, of course, has failed to talk about Inverness, which is a subject close to my heart. But the duelling of the A9 also requires the duelling of the railways up there to double track it up there. So that's something we can develop off the committee meeting. But thank you very much for your time this morning. And yeah, I'm sure we'll be seeing you again. So I'm going to suspend the meeting now to allow the witnesses to depart. And I think we go into private session. So we'll move into private session. Thank you.